Hello.
Daniel Lira.
How are you, Kakiro?
How are you, Daniel Lira?
I'm good. Good, good, good. What about you?
How is everything? I'm good. Good. I started drawing while you're setting up. I
You
feel
always
that
do.
it's a tradition that shouldn't really be broken. So I apologize if anyone wanted to see those first little moments of the underdrawing. We're going to do some painting today, so we're going to go
Yes.
straight into painting after this kind of quick sketch.
Yes.
But how are you? What's new?
What's new?
Yeah.
So we have something
What?
super cool announcement.
Oh my, I can't wait to hear this.
We
What are
said
you talking
we
about?
were going to do this on Monday.
Yeah, what?
Here we are
On
today,
Monday?
not Monday.
Monday,
And
Saturday the 11th.
we just released
Yeah.
the downloadable books, the downloadable PDFs
Yeah.
of our books. And I'm
Very
saying
nice.
our because we
Okay.
have available the PDF for the Painter book,
Yeah.
for the Our Painted Lives book,
Yeah.
for Possibilities, which was our last publication,
Yeah.
but also
What
we
is this?
created a new book, which is called More Possibilities,
Yeah.
which is 432 pages.
That seems like a lot.
It is a lot of amazing content, a
Yeah.
lot of amazing paintings,
Sounds like it.
and they are all available at our website. So you can download it. It has all the printing guides, the cutting guides. So if you want to just have it online and check it out, you can do
It
that. But
works.
also, if you want to print it,
Yeah.
you could go print it. So
Very
we are
nice.
very excited about that. I'm going to
Yeah.
share the link of our webpage if someone wants to go and check it out. And
Very
we also
nice.
have a bundle.
What?
So if you want to
Are
get.
you telling me that I don't have to buy like every single individual
No, you get a
PDF?
discount if you want to buy them all.
Oh my God.
Yeah.
How much is this?
So
How much is each book and how much is this bundle?
Painter,
Yeah.
OPL,
Our Painted Lives.
yeah, Our Painted Lives and Possibilities individually bought
Yeah.
are $10 each.
$10 each.
Yeah, so 10,
That's
10, 10, that would be
amazing.
30 for the three.
I'm throwing money at the screen right now.
And
It's bouncing back and I'm throwing it again.
the More Possibilities,
Oh, that's a
which,
huge
as I
book.
said,
That's
yeah,
probably $100.
432 pages.
That's $432 for
It's
sure.
$20. So
$20.
it would be 50 if
I
you
am
bought them.
spitting my spit take. I'm spitting my tea.
It would be 50 if you bought them separately.
That would be 50. Yeah, 10 plus 10 plus 10 plus 20. That's 50 in my brain, in
So
my
we have an amazing
accounting
discount
brain.
if you
What
want
is
the
that?
bundle
Yeah?
of all the books that I
Yeah?
just mentioned.
Yes.
You get them
I
for
would pay 70.
$40.
40?
You get them for
Double spit take.
$40. Yeah. Just
Again.
spit a
Oh my
tooth
God, my
out.
microphone is just full of
Yeah.
spit.
Yeah. I have to say,
What a
it's not
deal.
because it's something we did, but I have to
It's
say it is an
100% because of
amazing,
something that we did.
it is an amazing bundle.
I think it's
And
pretty
it is an
good.
amazing pricing if you just want to have
Yeah,
one.
maybe they have like the three of the last books printed.
Yeah.
Maybe they want the last one and they want to print it.
Or maybe you bought the Possibilities book.
Yeah, and you don't
But
have
you.
any of the other prior
No.
books.
Well, yeah, that too. But if you, for example, you go back to the book a lot,
Yeah.
as I was saying in the last stream, maybe you go a lot to it in your studio.
Yeah.
But then you're like, oh, I left it at home.
Oh,
Well, now you have it
I
in your
left it at my
computer.
mother's.
So you have it in your computer at an
Yeah.
amazing resolution.
Great.
And that's
My
amazing.
ex-partner threw it to the fire.
Or you can say, you
That
know what?
breakup.
I have the books, but
They
I just
deserved it.
want to have them in my studio also, but I don't want them to get messy because I can get paint on them.
Yeah.
So what can you do? You can buy
Can
these
buy
ones
another one. Oh, okay,
and you
yes.
can, no, because they're not available now.
Right, they're not.
So you could buy
Out of
these
print.
ones and go to them online on your
Yeah.
computer, or you can print them.
If you want physical ones, you can
You
go
could
print them.
print them and have
Printer of
it.
your choice.
Yeah, and as I was saying, you can use whatever paper if you're gonna use it in your studio,
Yeah, gold
so you don't
leaf.
feel So you don't feel bad for ruining it. If you do, if you stain it with painting, it's okay.
It's okay.
And you, again, if you stained it and...
We love it. Send the picture.
I mean, you have still the PDF, so you can reprint it.
Perfect.
So we are very excited for this. And we hope that a lot of you guys can enjoy it.
Yes.
And please let us know if you have it, if you're enjoying it, what do you think about it? We are very excited, I have to say.
Yes. So this is, I'm sure that because of this awesome pricing, this is going to be in the website for a very limited time.
For 2 days. No, I'm joking.
What?
It's going to be there.
Run.
Run now, yeah.
Run.
No, it's going to be.
Website crashing.
It's going to be there permanently.
Permanently. That's pretty amazing.
Yeah.
Yeah, that sounds like forever.
So if maybe you
permanently
don't have...
sounds like more time than an oil painting on paper, for example, would last. I don't know. Off the top of my head, I'm just thinking of things that don't last like a couple of days.
Well, a painting lasts a couple of days.
I'm sorry. On paper? Who are the idiots doing this?
No.
I wouldn't trust those people. As far as I can throw... My PDF book of more possibilities, which is not very far because it weighs a ton because it's 432 pages.
Oh, but it would
pages.
Be like a puck, terrible kick.
It's a puck shot.
With that.
It's a puck shot. It's like, the kick of the Lord of the Rings.
Yeah.
That broke his foot. Yeah.
432 pages.
Oh, my God. I don't even have 432 neurons.
Yeah. So.
So.
Yeah.
Amazing. So we'll see you tomorrow.
So I'm going to just put a little comment if you guys want to go click it. So I'm going to pin that comment. So.
Comment.
So new online. No. New.
What?
Downloadable.
Yeah.
PDF books.
So while Danny's doing that, we're going to use the palette that I've been using to paint all the Punch-Out characters, which is like a really cool kind of like earthy replacement for a primary color palette. It sounds like a stretch, but it's actually really, really fun. Titanium white. I have titanium white with dryers. Yellow ochre. Terra rosa. Where's my terra rosa? Terra rossa. You have to invoke your inner Italian. Terra rossa.
Say you're loud Italian.
Terra rossa.
You have to be that loud to be Italian. So now remember that Fer says that's okay.
But I'll gesticulate. Gesticulating isn't bad though. What else? Ivory black, which I have like a little bit, but I'm also going to use some raw umber. So. Kind of like neutral area right here. Or let's say neutral and blue. So we're going to have essentially a white, a yellow with the ochre, a red with the earth red, a blue with the black, and a neutral with the raw umber. I don't know why I said umber.
So if someone is maybe very curious about where Chili is.
Where is Chili? Here she is. She turned into a PDF.
She loves to be, like to...
Oh, tight. Yeah, who knows if that's... we could leave it there.
Let me just check.
Okay.
So I'll be back in a sec.
Okay, so while Danny's checking on something, I'm going to get started. I've been doing like an underdrawing, and then I feel it. These are big air quotes if you're not watching the video. I seal it with liquin, which is terrible, right? Like, why are you going to use, like, if the whole purpose of paper, you know, being this resilient, beautiful surface is to protect it first, seal it first, so that whatever you put on top of it doesn't seep into its fibers and then, you know, ruin it by being too acidic or, you know, whatever. Why would you ever put like an alkyd medium, an alkyd resin, as a sort of sealant. Sealant? Sealing.
I guess so. Sealant. Yeah.
Right. Yeah. That's a word.
Well, you're asking me, so.
I trust you.
It's like a flip of a coin, but I would say it exists.
A 20 face die. But yeah, so why use it as a sealant? I mean, I think I was a bit capricious when I, you know, thought, why don't I seal it with liquin? Like, what would be so terrible about it? I guess what would be terrible is if it is an aggressive medium, it's going to eat from the inside the paper. But then I'm thinking, like, well, what is it that would make a medium more aggressive, you know, when compared to sealing it with rabbit skin glue, or when compared to sealing it with, you know, if you have something on aerosol and you're just like, you know, sealing with a lacquer your drawing, which all that, you know, moisture that's in that lacquer is seeping into the paper also. Or what's different than just the paper sucking in an acrylic binder or a PVA? You know, in my brain, I was like, I guess all of them have like pros and cons. They're not, you know, it's not as if you can say, well, this is clearly the best option. I guess the best option would be something that is. That is not acidic at all, that it's pH neutral. So I thought, well, there's always like some sense of risk to all of this that's involved. And in my mind, I thought, well, the terrible thing about liquin is that, you know, we don't like it. And I say we as in if we insert ourselves in this sort of mindset where we want the painting to be malleable enough so that we can readjust it every whatever years, it could be every 100 years, every 150 years, so that we can like readjust it so that it feels balanced again. So that's why if we have a Damar varnish that will yellow with time, we can actually lift the Damar varnish. And especially nowadays, if we are protecting our paintings, let's say with some synthetic retouch varnish, we can put a retouch varnish first and sort of isolate our painting. And then as a final varnish, we apply Damar varnish. We could do that, or there's actually a bunch of like synthetic varnishes now available too that dry really quick, the yellow less, but probably those varnishes are going to yellow, or they're going to modify and sort of mutate into something else with time. And what restorers love is the ability to say, well, that yellowed, clearly yellowed, let's lift it up, get rid of it, and let's, you know, put a nice fresh coat of varnish again and protect our painting again and bring out those, you know, original, you know, kind of nice colors out. Whatever they are, it could be a gray muted painting, but let's bring out what was originally painted, let's say. The terrible thing, you know, big air quotes here, terrible thing about liquin is that it transforms. So as soon as it dries, it doesn't just oxidize and then creates a film, it actually transforms when it dries, and it gels up and it hardens. It actually hardens to a really kind of weird skin. It's a flexible skin, which is like a good thing. It's not like it's not brittle like rabbit skin glue, for example, that crystallizes and becomes really brittle. But it dries into this kind of yellowy flexible skin. So yellowing is going to be an issue. I think you kind of deal with that if you look at the color of liquin. I mean, it is a very dark sort of almost like purpley yellow, purpley red. I don't know. It's a weird color, but it's not as if that is going to dry, you know, transparent. It's not as if that's void of any hue. No, it has a very, very obvious color to it. So aside from that, I guess what would be terrible is that this thing that's seeping into the paper, it sort of gels and it transforms and it hardens. I mean, it hardens, but it's flexible once again. So that would be a good thing for paper, especially if you don't lay it on anything, if you're not mounting it on anything. But after that, I've been thinking about it, and paper would become very strangely stable, I feel. Aside from maybe that thing just eating up fibers, but I have a feeling, and this is, again, if there's a chemist, you know, that has used a lot of alkyd medium, maybe they can tell me, oh no, that thing is going to really eat up your paper fibers, you know, with time. But I don't know why I have a feeling. This is like painter intuition, and this is from somebody that has done tons of experimenting in painting and tons of things wrong, really, really wrong, so that I can understand them. Something tells me that both paper and alkyd medium sort of become one a little bit, you know, it kind of seeps into the fiber and it just becomes this surface, this kind of new surface, let's say. And it's actually quite, I don't know, it's quite strong. The paper actually weighs, I haven't put the paper on an actual like little scale to weigh it, but just from experience and from holding it, from handling it, I've noticed that the paper becomes heavier. The paper becomes a lot heavier. So, you know, if I grab like a regular piece, you know, of paper that I've janked out of my sketchbook, and then I put a paper where I've sealed it with liquin, I noticed that there's a significant amount of weight difference. So that's kind of cool. It just becomes like this heavier, like more robust surface. So now I'm not really thinking about paper. I'm thinking of surface, of like a substrate. And I'm noticing also that it doesn't really produce any weird issues regarding, let's say, absorption or rejection from the paint layer. The paper does become less absorbent. Like if you put your hand to the paper, if you just run it across the paper, you can clearly feel that there's like just like a little film, like a greasy film to it. And it's a little bit smoother than this paper, where you can actually feel kind of like the grain of the paper. You can feel, you know, how smooth the paper is. But, you know, with the other, with my alternative, let's say, of just applying liquin, you can kind of feel it's different. It's a little bit different. So it's a little smoother. So my fear was like, oh, maybe I'm sealing it too much, let's say, and it's becoming like less absorbent. So if I can close my eyes and imagine me doing it so much that I'm not painting on paper, but I'm painting on like this thin layer of alkyd medium that's very kind of rubbery and plasticky, I would have the fear that what I paint on top of that layer just kind of floats on that layer, but doesn't really get absorbed. So it could be easily peeled, let's say. Like if I run my finger through it, I could peel it, I could like scratch it. But that hasn't happened. Since I don't do it too much, since I just do like one layer and then I do my underpainting, which again has some liquid, some alkyd medium, I'm not doing it a ton of times because I try to go for a finish after that. So my paintings are 3, at most 4 layers when I'm doing them like this, like indirect painting. Well, I'm saying like this, but today I'm going to paint differently. I'm just going to go straight to paint because I'm missing it a little bit. But I've been noticing that it's strangely stable. It's quite stable. You can tell if somebody, if you can tell based on prior experiences, if something takes longer to dry, if paint just doesn't sit well on top, or if I, for example, put a final layer of like liquin on top, like a very thin final layer of liquin on top of my painting surface, if I'm picking up paint, because you know that the alkyd medium has solvent in it, so maybe you're risking picking up paint, and you kind of risk the picking up the paint when paint hasn't absorbed, for example, and it's just like floating on like a layer because it can't really adhere to that layer, or it doesn't get absorbed. Or because it's becoming less permeable, the paint surface, then it's just taking a longer time for paint to dry. And none of those things have happened. They've been, again, strangely stable. So I've been kind of happy doing that with the Punch Out series. I'm really, really like wonderfully surprised by that little shift that I did. And I said, well, you know, what's the point? Like, if people are fine, like spraying alcohol-based or lacquer-based fixatives on top of a drawing and then painting on them and having all that fixative just seep into the surface or seep into a paper, like, why would you not be okay with just putting some alkyd resin on top of it too? Mind you, there is a difference between what you can spray and what you can lay with a brush. I'm aware of that. I'm probably doing it, like, the volume I'm using is probably way more in terms of what I can brush with my liquid than what I can spray with my fixatives. But I was like, I might as well give it a try. I don't know of many people that do this, so I can't really base it on anyone else's experience. Nobody really paints on paper this much. I think as much as we've done it, at least painting with oils on paper. So I think we're just, you know, sort of feeling our way through things and kind of learning how surfaces are behaving. But I've been painting on paper for the last, I'd say, you know, consistently for the last maybe 5 years, maybe a little more than that. Maybe 6 years.
More because our Painted Lives was right on paper.
Yeah, so maybe 6 years. And I've yet to see something that feels or looks problematic, like immediately problematic, that you would say, wow, there's an issue. There's an obvious issue here. You have to deal with it. You have to change things. You have to, you know, adjust. Just don't be stubborn. Just adjust. I don't. I've never had that experience. So I don't know. You know, I think that because we're not overdoing it, which is the worst thing that you can do in a painting, just layers and layers and layers. And if you're mixing mediums and, you know, if you are doing so much weird things, so many weird things, like a concoction of mediums and drying times, that's the worst recipe. But if you're doing a super simple painting where I just have one, I'm just using one medium when I use it, because I use it sparingly. Like, for example, in these paintings, I use it as a sealant. I also use it to do my underpainting, and then I don't use it at all. You know, when I do the painting, it's just paint. So it's a very, very, you know, kind of conservative use of that medium. And when I use it, I use, you know, I don't use a lot of it. So it's pretty much, you know, paint on top of this prepped surface. And everything has been going well until now. You know, mm-hmm. I'm thinking of doing like a painting for myself to try and keep, because I've never done this really.
With what?
Yeah, just a painting that I'll do for myself and then keep it for 10 years or whatever.
Because we have the chili painting. And I think right. I think you used liquid.
No. That chili painting is just straight painting.
Yes, oh, okay. Straight painting. I don't know why I thought
No. Like the Tyson series? No, we don't have anything like that.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, I think I'm going to do one for myself and just look at it. Just see how it changes and see how maybe monitor it.
Wouldn't it be cool?
You know, just for future, just to know. Honestly, just to know.
The you version if you were in Punch-Out?
Me in Punch-Out?
Like your you character?
Oh, that would be cool.
Yeah.
I would be probably the first, I would be before Glass Joe.
Yeah.
I feel. I would be the first character.
But don't you think it would be cool?
Yeah. Yeah.
And to keep it?
That's pretty cool. Yeah, that could be really cool. I clearly don't belong there, so. No, well, that could be really nice.
So,
anyways, let's say hi and I'll just.
Yeah, so before.
So I'm going to go straight to paint, okay? Straight to paint. And if there's PDF questions.
Yeah, so I was going to answer one.
You can go ahead and answer all of those.
Yeah, so if you have any questions, please let us know. regarding everything, but of course regarding the books. If you have a question about something, we can help you out here. So Wishlist 011 was saying, "Hi there. Sorry if I'm missing something in the description from the link.
Yes.
The PDF at $40 is 400 pages of images, etc." So no, the 41 has not only the book that has 432 pages,
the
$40.
Oh,
the
yeah.
$40 bundle.
Let's call it the bundle.
Has
yeah.
The More Possibilities book, which has 432 pages, plus the other three books. So I think we did the calculation, and it was around 900 pages.
Around 900 images, I feel.
At all.
Yeah.
You know, like pages. Yeah, because there's like.
Yeah. Yeah, well, pages would be, I would feel better just saying there's over 900 images. If you get the bundle,
yeah.
There's over 900 images.
Yes.
That,
because if I'm not mistaken, I mean, I know the Possibilities book has 200 pages. The More Possibilities, which is the new one, has 432 pages.
Yeah.
And if I'm not wrong, the other one was 150 and 150.
I think so, yeah.
So you would have 150, 150. 200 and yeah. Then 432.
So what people are getting, just to be super clear, and it's actually super simple. When you pick a book, let's say you're picking the Possibilities book, what you have is actually a link where you can download, you'll be able to download three or four files. So why is it three or four? If let's say it's three files, you're going to get the book, the cover, you know, which is a wraparound cover. So you can actually, you know, give that to the printer and you'll get a front cover and a back cover. Sometimes we have end papers that are for the front cover. Sometimes we have front end papers that are for the back cover. And sometimes we have just end papers for both front and back cover. Mm-hmm. So if there's three files, you're going to get the end papers, the wraparound cover, and the book. If there's four, it's because you're going to get both front cover and
papers. Because it had different end
covers.
Back
cover and papers.
Yes.
Exactly. That's the way we designed it. And it's super easy. You just download those and that's it.
Then
but yes,
then you have it.
What,
yeah.
What Danny was saying, for the bundle, you're going to get all of it. You're going to get those three or four files for each of the publication. And you could just download them. They're yours to keep. And you can print them for personal and non-commercial use. And you can print them as many times as you want. If you want to keep one and then give one to your partner, give one to your mother, give one to an artist friend, you can totally do that. So now, you know, of course, you can print it however you want. The print, since it's print ready, it means that there's a size that's already preset for each PDF.
And it has the cutting lines.
Yeah, it has all the guidelines. It has all the guidelines that we would give to the printer. These are actually the files that we gave to the printers. So, mm-hmm. You know, the actual original files that we gave to the printers. So, let's say the our Painted Lives book is actually the size of a Moleskine sketchbook because it was a one-to-one reproduction. No, it's okay. The Our Painted Lives, the Painter book was actually a little bit bigger. Then the Possibilities book was a lot bigger. And the one that we just did, the More Possibilities, is actually the same size as the Possibilities book.
Yep.
So it's the same design, same size. So you can expect the two of them to be like partner books. And it's actually super, super simple.
Yeah. And also, I was going to say, if you go to the webpage and you click on the book you're interested in, you can see a description.
Yes.
So you can know, okay, I'm getting the More Possibilities PDF, the bundle. Or,
yeah. And what you see, the images that we picked for the product image, they're actually actual paint page samples.
Mm-hmm.
So that's what a page or a spread, you know, more precisely. These are actually spreads. So this is what a spread would look like.
Gade Gaby dice, hola chicos, ¿hasta cuándo estará disponible?
Hasta siempre.
Hola Gade Gaby, ¿van a estar disponibles en la página?
Hasta que me muera.
Hasta que se caiga la página, sí, no sé. Van a estar, o sea, la idea es que estén ahí de ahora en adelante para quien quiera.
Sí, estamos pagando un servidor particular
para poder
para poder tenerlas ahí, pues
Exacto.
sí, si seguimos pagando el servidor, pues van a seguir estando allí.
So let's say hi.
Yes.
Javi Hav was saying, hello, hello, beautiful people of the OPL world. Qué sorpresa en sábado. Claro que sí, porque hoy es un día muy importante con los
Sí.
PDFs. Entonces, aquí
Y
estamos.
para saludar a Javier Javio.
A Javi to have you. Patricia Salazar was saying, hey. Hey, Patricia, how
Patricia.
are you? Catherine Peremski was saying, hello on a Saturday. I
Yay.
already purchased the PDFs and I can tell you how exci and I can't tell you how excited I am.
Oh, that's
I was so
awesome.
sad when I missed the boat on the book, but sad no more and a happy
Oh, that's
face. Oh,
excellent.
that's
Thank you
so
so much,
cool.
Catherine.
Thank you so much for getting it, Catherine. Radek was saying, hey. Hey, Radek. Chapulín Colorado was saying, bundle. Yes, there's a bundle.
Yeah. And I think they're priced very fairly.
Very.
Yeah, we looked at Gumroad, books that were offered, PDF books that were offered. I also checked to see how many people are granting permission to print things for personal non-commercial use, and very few people, if at all, are granting people that buy these the permission. But we are doing that. So you can go and print it for yourself and make like a super nice, super nice quality book if you want to, or you can, maybe find a little more affordable options to print your book, and which that's also awesome, but that's up to, everyone here. So
Yes. Fernanda Uribe está diciendo hola.
mi ferchuchis,
Hola la Fer.
ahí nos está
Hola la
oyendo.
Fer.
Uy.
Cody Winicky was saying, hey guys, going to get the more possibilities now.
Oh,
Oh,
that's so,
that's so
you're so
cool,
kind.
Cody.
Thank you.
Let us know what you think about it.
Lettuce.
Let us know. A ver, Chile. Artemis Sakiri was sending a thumbs up. Hey, Artemis. Welcome here. Isabel Olmedo dice, buenas noches desde Huelva. Hola, Isabel. ¿Cómo está, Isabel? Buenas tardes.
Sí,
Desde
vuelva,
Bogotá.
vuelva, ojalá vuelva.
Sean Farley was saying, hi, Nico and Dani.
Sean.
Downloading the big bundle now. Oh, that's amazing. Thank you so much, Sean.
Thank you, Sean.
And how are you, Sean? Long time no see over here.
Sean, you probably have this info. Eglis book, where are you getting it from? And if you can send me a DM with a link, because I looked into it and I want to get it. I want to get the physical copy, like a hardcover when it comes out. But I was looking and there's like a bunch of European sites. I know that Casa del Libro maybe is carrying it in Spain, but I want to see if there's something that is a little more international friendly, I'm guessing. I mean, I guess that that would be fine too, but if you have any info on that, I would appreciate it.
Carla and Glara.
Carlita and Glada.
No, Carla Cita,
Carla
remember.
Cita de Carne. Yeah.
Carla Cita was saying, hi, sweet chili, Danny, Nicolas, and chat. Yay, I bought the bundle.
Oh, no way. Thank
Oh,
you.
thank you,
Thank you
Carla.
so much,
And Carla was saying, sweet
Carla Cita.
chili, keeping safe and warm. Yeah, the chair. She was sitting here while
Yes.
I went over there. Cody was saying, ghost. Does the same thing, only he's about 10 times bigger.
Oh, I'm
Haha.
guessing it's not that comfortable for you.
Yeah, so if Ghost gets the chair, then it's done. And also, remember that Cody is tall.
Yeah,
So it's not
Cody
like
calls couches chairs. So, yeah, so that's a problem.
I'm gonna share
Oh,
the
God.
chair with
With Cher.
Ghost. So, yeah. I mean, I have plenty of room when I'm sitting with Chili. We're both petite,
No, I
so.
have to like I am buttless, but I even have to like, just push forward to the edge.
No,
of
I
the,
have to do that too.
That seat is so uncomfortable. I have
really?
To tell you, yeah, it's
I think
terrible.
It's so comfortable to sit like I sit.
Yeah, I think it's
it
it's
has
made for
too
you.
Much room.
I think it's made for you.
But for the streams, because if I was carving in this chair,
no, I can't.
I would
yeah.
die of a
when I have to be in the
broken back
in the computer for like a little bit, for like more than I wish I would. You know, I was there for.
Mm-hmm.
I don't enjoy it.
Yeah. Yeah, but for this, for lounging.
Lounging.
Si, 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 si.
Well, yeah, I guess.
Well, yeah, you say it like that. Well, not you. People say it like
yeah.
that. For lounging.
Not you, people.
Not you, yeah.
Normal
cool people.
People.
yeah, it's very comfortable for this only.
Yeah.
But yeah, because I remember I bought this as a desk chair.
Okay.
And like a working chair. And it's not comfortable as a working
It's not
chair.
Working.
By the way, is there anyone here, maybe? This is like kind of a random question.
Okay.
But
this is
has anyone
good.
Here tried the...
LSD.
No, the chairs that you sit on your knees.
Oh, that's...
Like
we
knee,
are so not going to get anything
no,
remotely
maybe
close
you,
to that.
You're not going to get it. Maybe I'm going to get
no,
it.
No, but that's not going to be... Like, we're
well,
never going to use
you.
That.
For me, yeah.
Never.
When I carve,
that. No.
It can be very useful. So, can someone let me know?
Why don't you try it? Try working on your knees for like a whole day and
no, because
see.
It's not like that. It's not like I'm gonna put my knees on the floor.
No, no, no.
And
just,
be hurting.
I don't know. Like, use a chair or something.
You can't use a chair like that. How?
Oh, like you need these special chairs.
Of course.
Oh God.
So I'm not gonna lend it to you if I buy it.
Oh.
Let's,
I'm
oh god
I'm totally fine without it. I am 100% fine without it. Perchuchis. Per. ¿Será para ti? Ah, bueno. So yeah, we're not while Danny is getting that. We're not getting the knee chair. No.
Not yet.
No. We're not getting the knee chair. Nope. That is my knee-jerk reaction.
Ready. Yeah.
Ready to kneel
ready,
10 hours a
rumble.
Day, so that you could carve comfortably.
Well, I think I'm gonna get it. I want to see some reviews.
Well,
I saw one
of the
chair.
Three people that have gotten it.
No.
The inventor's
no.
mother.
No.
Yeah. See.
So.
Pues, ¿tú bajas solita, mi Fer? Bueno,
let's
te amo.
See.
Juiciosa, con cuidado.
So, Bartlomiej de Bosch, tell me, Verchungis, was saying, I tried that chair when I was little. It was a wonderful race car when turned backwards. So, that's a great review.
No, but
not what I'm intending.
No, and when you're little, you can lie on, like, you know, a chair made of broken glass, and you're fine. You're like, oh, this is fun. No, I've never seen a child say, my back hurts. Never. Oh my God, this was terrible on my knees.
Oh, but I got this.
They are like made of Gumby.
So let me throw you under the bus because
what?
I got this gaming chair.
Yeah, it's terrible.
That you said, Danny, this is amazing. This has changed the way I feel when I work. You have to get it. And I was like, yeah, let me try
okay,
it.
Okay, knowing
like,
myself,
no,
I think
it
that's
is an amazing
a terrible
thing.
Representation
you have
of
to.
Myself. I never sound so passionate about a chair.
You
so.
Were passionate, and I bought it,
no.
and it's terrible, and
maybe
it
a
hurts,
statue. Maybe
and it
a
was
statue.
Expensive, and it's terrible. So you don't even have it anymore.
Samu uses it, but again,
but he uses it like
he
just like puts it all back.
He just
so
like
he's
slinks.
Just like,
he just
like
slinks.
A second bed on it.
Yeah, he's
and he just
he's
puts,
like a mutt on. He's like a street dog, Samu. He could, you know, he can outlive anyone. I feel.
So, Catherine Poremski was saying, my mom had one of those knee chairs many years ago. I'm not convinced they're that great.
Thank you. Mm.
Philip Murphy was saying, those chairs will destroy your precious knees.
Yeah. Okay. That's and like being a catcher.
Shannon like Hagen.
Every single minute of every day.
Shannon Hagen was saying, plus one for the knee chair. They're so good.
Oh, Jesus.
Why do you like them? I want to know,
who
Shannon.
Was this, Shannon? Blocked.
Shannon,
you're buying it from us once we're done with it in like 2 weeks.
Bartlomiech Dobosch was
Shannon
saying...
Shannon probably makes them.
Bartlomiech was saying, I second that the chair is mediocre.
Thank you.
Really puts everything on your back. Stretches are better for your knees. Stretches?
Mm. Yeah, well, yeah, what's the point of being on your knees?
To have a good posture.
I mean, you can get strong back and just have a good posture. My posture has gotten so much better over
when
the
I
years.
Work, I don't have a good posture.
You have a terrible posture, but that's on you. That's not the chair. You know I'm right. You know no. I'm right about that. That is no. like lack of self-discipline. Coming from somebody who had a horrendous...
Who has a terrible discipline. No, what? You have a great
oh, yeah.
discipline.
Oh, right.
The one that
the
paints every
that
day.
Paints,
yeah, yeah,
like,
yeah.
Like every single day of his life.
No, in that thing, you have a good discipline.
Well,
in other things.
In that thing, yes. In that thing, that's like the quintessential thing that you do in life, sure, you're disciplined.
But I have to say, I have good discipline in other things.
No, you're very disciplined. But regarding your posture, you're not. And you know this. I've told you.
I
you
just get very uncomfortable.
You're just like a ferret. You just move around and you get into this weird position that can't be good for you. You know it. You know I'm right. I know you don't like when I'm right, but in this particular thing, like I'll give you all the other arguments where I'm wrong and I'm just stubborn. In this particular argument, you know that I'm right. You have a terrible posture.
Jeff Akov was saying, chair made of broken glass. LOL, Nico.
Yeah, I mean, kids. They're like drunk people.
So
kids and drunkards.
Margarita Neves was saying, hello, can I purchase the book in euros?
Yes, you can.
Yeah, for sure, in our webpage. I mean, you can see the price of it in dollars.
Yeah,
but
whatever
you will pay in your
currency. In your currency.
Yeah.
It's just an online purchase.
Yep.
Like any other thing you purchase online.
Carla was saying, I think if the chair would help your knees back and help you in your carving, you should get it, Danny. Thank you, Carla.
Oh, Carla.
Thank you for not being intrusive in my...
Well, she is being intrusive.
In the things I want to buy.
Okay.
Wink, wink.
Oh, so you can... You're not intrusive if you just agree.
Yeah, because she's saying, I think if you... feel like you want to have it.
Oh, Carla Sita, you're losing your Sita. You're losing your Sita.
Shannon Hagen was saying, ha ha ha, bet I'll take it. And Shannon was also saying, Danny, for real? They make your back straight. They take the stress off your lower back. And they have cushy knee pads.
Cushy. Yeah.
I think cushy is another thing.
I think cushy is another type of...
Yeah, cushy knee pads.
Cushy.
So good for ferrets. Oh, I love it. So maybe it's made for me and Shannon.
Oh, my God. Yeah, two chairs bought.
You know, I'm trying to see
if
they
the company's like
sell
super
it
happy with
somewhere
you
here.
Where?
But not online, but that you
here
can go
in Bogota?
Yes.
There's no chair like
so
that
So I want
here.
To see if someone
Nothing.
Sells it here so I can no. like... Let me talk, Nicolas, to see if I can try it so I can maybe get it. I saw another one that was for sitting backwards, that you can sit up front and backwards.
Why are we looking for chairs that are not chairs?
But that one's very expensive.
Oh, my. That one. Oh, my God.
Why don't we just rip
money and just throw it out, like out the window? I think that'll make a good chair. Let's just throw money away.
Gil was saying bombastic side eye from Danny. I think I gave you a side eye. I'm sorry.
Oh, it's fine. No. We're okay. Don't worry. This is our bit.
This is how we are always. Yeah.
This is how we argue with each other.
Henry Downs was saying you too. Ha ha ha. LOL. Ferret friendly. Woohoo. Of course. And I have to say that chili. I mean, I know that chili is like my animal soulmate.
Spirit animal.
But look at her. I mean, she has my posture.
Yeah, well, she's a dog, you know.
Well, I'm not.
I'm going to start giving you dog food then. Yeah.
Well, she doesn't eat dog food.
So. Well, no, you're right. It's some sort of food, so.
It's food. Yeah, it's not like kibble, so.
Okay.
Cody Winnicky was saying, I only sit in chairs backwards and upside down, and it has to have a rocking function. This knee chair seems like it's not pushing the boundaries of design enough. No, there's one. I want to see the name
Wait,
of it.
What is this? Like, what is Cody? What are you using, Cody? It has to be backwards and it has to rock? Which I also understand that Cody's like 8'4", but, you know, and it probably has like special needs, but what are these chairs? Like, when did chairs become enough?
So, I think I shared this with a cousin.
Oh, God.
Let's see.
Let's not see. Please, help me.
I don't know if I share it here. Because if I didn't... No, it's not here.
Oh, shame.
Ah.
Not buying it today. Shame.
No, because I was going to share the one that's very expensive, which I've heard very good reviews.
Of course. Great reviews.
But
yeah.
So give me one sec and I'll give you the reference because I just...
Jesus Christ.
I think I have a workaround.
I have it in my cart.
No. It doesn't sell on Amazon or something like that. It sells from the like chair
of
brand.
Of course. Yeah. Why would they make it like... available.
So, let's see. Maybe someone knows here the one I'm talking about and they can help me out. Maybe they have no idea and they're not interested.
Oh, I would be so grateful for those people.
So, I think it's here. No.
Well, we could leave it for another day. You know,
no.
It's a shame. I'm so interested.
No.
No, I'm gutted. I am gutted. Definition of gutted. I'm a fish.
Jesus Christ. Here.
So I'm making a mess out of the head, but I'm searching. We'll get there. It's all necessary. It's like a necessary mess.
I know.
Now I use my maul stick, by the way, because it has helped my elbow, my shoulder, my wrist, knees and toes.
I think you need it.
Yeah,
a lot.
It has
and you
helped.
Were a little bit stubborn, but
a lot
now
of
it's
it.
Helping.
Yeah, a lot of it. A lot of it.
I want to... No.
No.
Where is it?
It's okay, Danny.
I knew I had it somewhere.
It's okay. It's so okay. Trust me, sometimes the universe like knows best. It's like, yeah, I know you saved this in your cart. I know you put your credit card information.
Maybe someone here knows.
But you know what?
So Cody was saying I was being sarcastic.
Oh, thank you, Lord.
Philip Murphy was saying a good adjustable wooden piano stool is excellent.
Excellent.
No, for me. Not for me.
No, it's just great for pianists that have to be sitting down, you know, every day of their lives.
Henry Downs was saying, LOL, when chairs get weird. And Shannon was saying, no, Cody, stand your ground.
Stand down, Cody. Stand down.
I know. Now I can't just think about anything else.
Oh, I got. I mean, it's a sad moment when you have to give, you know, say goodbye to your chair dreams. But it happens. We've all been there, Danny. It happens.
This one. So it's called...
Fuck me.
H-A with a weird thing.
Of course, it doesn't even have a fucking name.
No, that's the brand, Nikita.
I know, of course. Of course it does.
It's called...
It
Hag?
Okay.
I don't know how to say the brand.
Oh, of course. It's probably like Dutch. It's probably like Swedish or something.
And it is the Capisco chair.
Oh, is this like Swedish design? Tell me if it is. It's probably.
So it says the Hag Capisco 8106 is the classic bestseller model.
Oh, of course it is.
The saddle seat can be adjustable between low and high working positions and all the way up to a standing position, enabling you to do more, to be more dynamic in your movements while still sitting in a balanced position.
Oh, so thoughtful of them.
And
you know what's a dynamic
ask
position?
Ask for prize.
Stand up from your chair.
That sounds very...
Stand up and walk.
Sounds very expensive. If they don't give you the prize...
Oh, it's all, yeah.
In the webpage.
Yeah, how do you know then? Well,
Hag Capisco chair prize.
Sold out. Sad.
No, it is on Amazon.
Oh, look at that.
What?
Yeah. That could either be two things. I know Danny.
So it's $1,000.
Cheaper than what she thought?
So it's $1,038.
Okay. I'm not even going to comment.
Yeah. So it's not something I'm going to get.
No.
But I think it's very cool.
So the dream died quickly.
No, it died months ago when I saw the price. But there's just some days that I go back and just look at it.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
Just dream about it.
Ah, I mean, it's a nice dream.
I think that would help me be more productive.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, I respect your dream. I really, really, really respect your dream. And I'm very sad. Super saddened by the fact that it's unabashedly expensive.
Yeah. Thank you. I'm sorry. I mean, when you said I respect, I just like tuned out.
Okay.
Because I don't like lies. So I'm sorry. Cody was saying,
so bad for you,
nothing screams dynamic motion like sitting.
Yeah.
Catherine was saying, I think the main thing about when you're working is to take stretching breaks. That would probably just as advantageous.
Advantageous?
As whatever. Advantageous? Okay. No, I can't say
okay.
It.
Don't.
Advantageous.
Don't.
Advantageous.
There you go.
As any chair.
Yes.
Catherine was saying Cody and laughing faces. Henry Downs was sending laughing faces. What's wrong with my brain?
I don't know. Maybe you need a better chair.
Yeah. This chair is like it's ruining
messing.
My...
Could you imagine? Like you buy the $1,000 chair. $1,300? $1,038? Plus shipping, by the way.
Yeah.
Oh, and if we want it here, you know that we would be paying another $1,000 for the chair. So so let's say $2,000 for this beautiful chair. Could you imagine perfect English if you start using your chair?
What are you talking about? I have a perfect English.
Okay, I'm just going to leave it.
Jeff Aikoff was saying, OMG, the Amazon product images for the Capisco chair are effing hilarious. So now everyone's Team Nicolas laughing about this.
But no,
when
come
I'm
on.
Having the perfect posture and
no.
You're not.
Just I don't complain
give
about
give me a call and it'll give
I
you the reference
about that
of the chair.
That's like a I don't even know what that chair is for. But it's not comfortable.
It's for streaming. I mean it's for streaming while carrying a dog.
Oh yeah, that's a highly specific use.
Well the use I
for like
need
petite
it for.
People. Yeah.
Yeah. Henry Downs was saying, yeah, stretching is great advice. Bartlomiej Dubosch was saying, OPL chair special stream and a heart emoji. Nathan Parrott was saying,
yeah, we have more people clicking on the looking for the chair than for the PDF files of our.
So please, if you went to see the chair, just give a look. See.
Yeah.
Give our webpage look.
Yeah, just have it
is
a tab
amazing
open.
Bundle. And if you don't want the bundle and you just want single books, it is also amazing. Yeah. So
way less expensive than the chair, I'd say.
Oh, way less.
Yeah.
So I'm going to just share randomly our webpage over there.
That'd be nice.
If someone wants to click it.
If anyone wants to.
Nathan Parrott was saying, Nicolas, you're making me and my wife laugh. Love the painting today. And
thank
a heart
you.
Emoji. this is my day-to-day with Nicolas.
This is my day-to-day.
I'm like, Nicolas, do you want
Danny.
To see something amazing I saw? Oh, what's that stupid thing?
No, I never prejudge it like that. It's
prejudge
just that-
it? You're prejudging. I was like, oh, there's a knee chair. And you were like, that's stupid. That sounds stupid.
Okay.
Who would use that? Who wants to be in your knees? That's stupid.
Who wants to be in your knees? Yeah, that's another type of chair, Danny. No. I'm just saying that I usually don't go for those. No, I'm going to say this. Well, I don't go for stuff that I don't think necessary, that I don't think it's strictly necessary. And I'm also like super basic. You know this. Like I'm fine with, like if the bed is fine, like up until I met you, I considered that I could sleep on a better mattress. And you were right. It's actually a big difference when you have a, you know, slightly better mattress.
Slightly.
Well, way better mattress.
God, I bought it and it was expensive.
I mean, some people buy ones that are like priced like a car. You know,
well,
there's mattresses that are
I don't
ridiculous.
Have that budget, but I had a...
I know, but ours...
I mean, it's a
so
good
I'll give
mattress.
You that. But my whole life I've been like, no, I'm fine. If it does its job, it's fine for me. So I'm usually very apprehensive about things that I feel like who needs this? Like, this is ridiculous. But on the other hand, and I'm not saying I'm right and you're wrong. On the other hand, you are very excited about things that are different.
Of course.
You are. You're always super, super excited about things that are like, hey, we never had a problem with a table, but here's a new table. And you're always like, it always catches your eye.
Yeah.
Because I think you have satisfaction. You have a ton of satisfaction if you're able to either make something or own something. And I'm not going to say that it sounds exclusive, that nobody owns, but it's just like
a gadget.
Yeah.
Like a cool gadget.
Like,
you're right.
And then somebody shows up and you're like, hey, you didn't even know you had this problem, but just test this. Test drive this.
No, but it's not like...
You love
trying
those
to
things.
Sell it to someone else.
No. Well, you know,
but
you don't want to be the only one on earth buying the thing.
But yeah, I have to say,
no, you like
I'm
that.
Attracted to those like dumb, random gadgets.
Yes, I would say
I like that.
Yes.
Yeah.
And I don't. And I think that that's I always find that like super cool about you.
Do you?
But,
I don't think so.
But,
let's go with that. Yeah.
Let's keep the wallet far from those desires.
Well, I never say that when you're trying to get something.
Come on, a statue
for
is
you.
Not,
yeah,
statue is amazing.
Or a figure, but
come on, those are proven to make you happier.
So Cody was saying the book is a steal compared to the chair. Of course,
It's a steal.
Why? Why wouldn't you get the books?
Because you're buying a chair, and maybe you're in horrible debt.
No.
You know what?
If you're getting that
the
chair,
painting,
you have the budget to
the
buy
one. The one. You know, the Soda Popinski painting.
Which is
cheaper.
Available.
Cheaper.
Oh, so I'm going to share it here.
Cheaper
that
than
is
the painting.
A great deal.
Cheaper than the chair.
Cheaper than the painting.
Cheaper than the painting. Cheaper than the chair. I mean, it's a painting.
And I have to say that it's going to last more.
You know what? If you hang it and if you appreciate it, you know what's straight? Your back. While you're looking at it, you're appreciating it. It's in your wall. Posture's nice. You just hang it at an appropriate height. For Cody, it would be 10'2" on the wall. He needs like special walls. But that's a painting. The one of a kind thing that I did very lovingly.
And
the
for
other
Cody,
thing,
I think
it's
with
a
the
chair
new
meant to like rip people off.
With the new motor from the AC.
Oh.
I think he has to like hang it outside.
Yeah.
Because
no.
Then it would just like fall.
No, you gotta how expensive that was. You have to sleep in that fucking motor.
Let's see. C.C. Vinks was saying, love you guys. I thank you. And welcome here, C.C. Vinks. Carlos Rial.
Rial.
Was saying, hello, OPL in chat. Hola, Carlos. Hola, Carlos.
I'm telling you. All of this would improve if you were kneeling.
Maybe that's it. That's my problem. Joel Kisbert was saying, estaba diciendo, me encantó la última película del gato con botas. No la hemos visto.
No la hemos visto.
Sabemos que sale un chili.
Sí, un sí. Chili igualito, que se llama perro, chili. Creo.
Perrito. Y en serio me gustaría ver un fanart tuyo de Jack Horner. Si eso no pasa en un futuro cercano, quizá me anime a intentarlo.
No sé quién es, pero voy a investigar.
Toca mirar. No, y también, si Joel dice que si no pasa en un futuro cercano, quizás se anime a intentarlo, debería intentarlo igual.
100%, claro.
Y que nos muestre a ver qué tal. ¡Ay!
Chila, casi te caes, chila.
Se está tratando de ir hacia ti.
No. Si estuvieras arrodillada, tendrías más control sobre ella.
Ella, yo le compraría una silla de perro para arrodillarse.
Ah, bueno.
Para que tengamos buena postura las dos. So where were we before this chair talk?
I don't know. You were gonna press the buy now button.
No, it's very expensive.
Yeah.
I mean, I know there's like crazy expensive desk
anything.
Chairs.
Yeah, any. There's crazy expensive everything.
Yeah,
out
dot
there.
Dot dot. Yeah, that's yeah. True. But actually, I think that's very out of my budget for a chair.
Well, it's. I mean, if it was.
No, but also
miraculous.
Because I. And we have to bring it here.
And you don't have a bad back, by the way. You just have bad posture.
Yeah.
But it's just. I mean.
No, and you know, I mean, to be honest, yeah. My back never hurts.
I know.
I don't know how.
You never suffer from your back.
I sit terribly. Yeah. I mean, when I'm carving, I could be sitting like this and just like this.
Chili.
Sorry, she opened it.
The bathroom or the door. She's eating toilet paper now, so we have to keep everything closed. Yeah, she was eating the toilet paper once again.
She was taking a nap on the shower.
Yeah, maybe her back hurt.
Look at your little paws with water, Chili. Let's see. So where were we? I was saying that I have a terrible posture, but my back never hurts.
Never.
So.
Oh, Danny, could I bother you for like a second?
Go ahead.
No, I just don't have
Toilet paper.
Toilet paper. Chili's gonna get that. Yeah.
Kitchen
paper
towel. Yeah. Paper towel.
Thank you so much. Thank you. I'm so sorry. Thank you. Because I don't use solvent, I have to resort to just wiping my brushes constantly with a paper towel. Vente out. No, it's okay. Danny. Yeah, but it's okay. Danny has a bad grip.
You have
to. Nope. No, I don't. Yeah, I have to clean my brushes with a paper towel constantly, but I always forget the paper towel. So, which is fine, because then I get like a bunch of super cool grays that I can, you know, I can make the painting Like mud harmonious, so that's a good thing too. No rush, Danny. No rush. No, you're going to break something over there. Don't rush. Don't rush. Yeah, I don't know. I don't know why you're rushing. I'm already using more brush, way more brushes than I thought I was going to use. And I don't know why I'm stuck with the portrait so much. But, we'll see. If I'm noticing that I'm just like I'm spending way too much time with it and it just makes no sense, I'll then force myself to move to the other areas of the painting. We'll see. I just need for it to work, because then the other areas of the painting are kind of abstract. They're super open, so we just need to make this work.
So.
Are you good? You were rushing over there a little bit. Yeah. Don't worry.
I was trying to get a little bit of sparkling water with lime, I guess. But I was trying to be very fast, so I wasn't missing the stream.
Oh, it's okay.
And I almost
bought a chair.
Yeah, and I accidentally bought the chair. I don't know how.
Oh, no. Just the finger slipped.
Jeff Acob was saying, get some fiber in her diet.
Chili or Danny?
For chili, because of the paper, I guess. Oh. No, you know what's the thing?
I thought it was like on Danny so that she can have a better posture.
She doesn't need that chair, yeah.
No, she's just being playful. She just likes the...
She just discovered that because she doesn't eat it. She just like bites it. But then she just like takes the paper and walks.
Yeah,
so...
I think she's just being super playful with it.
Yeah.
That's it.
Catherine Peremsky was saying, my dog used to eat tissues out of the trash can.
Oh, Jesus
And
Christ.
A vomiting emoji.
Oh, that's how COVID started.
Oh, God. Yeah, that is...
disgusting. Patient zero.
That is something.
Yeah.
Yeah. So let's go back to when I was saying hi before the chair talk.
Mm-hmm.
I think we need it. Knee.
Oh, Jesus Christ. Need it. Yeah.
Jatuki was saying, hi, Nicolas and Danny.
Jatuki.
You can't resonate with anybody who thinks that using liquin is a terrible idea. In my mind, the terrific thing about liquin, it just makes my painting scarier because it helps me to better mix the colors. LOL.
Okay.
Let's see. Raimo Galí. Alias, Sandalias. Sandalias dice, buenas, felicidades por el PDF.
Tan
dice,
amable.
Vengo de hacer, muchas gracias antes que nada, sí. Sandalias. Y dice, vengo de hacer una primera sesión de plein air.
Uy, se quemó, ¿no?
Ha sido horrible. Ha sido horrible, dijo.
¿Por qué?
En 10 minutos de empezar a pintar, se me ha tapado el sol y en cuanto la nube había pasado, ya había salido la luna.
No, pero...
De pronto la hora estuvo difícil.
Sí.
La hora elegida no era, quizás no era la mejor.
Sí, pero... sí, es que estoy pensando en hora española. De pronto a esa hora la luz es muy efímera. La calidad de la luz es muy efímera y muy cambiante. Pero de pronto ese era el reto. De pronto ese era el reto de San Gales.
I think you...
Taki?
No, I have a terrible thing.
What?
Because...
No, you're not.
No.
You're not terrible. I mean...
When you...
Even good people can have bad taste. The chair thing is fine.
Well, I mean, you're saying bad taste and I'm with you, so don't say that.
Okay. What were we going to say?
No, that I don't know why I always overthink. Like, when I say someone's name wrong.
Yeah, it's fine.
Then I overthink how to say it. So if I'm thinking how is the proper way to say it, uh-huh. I don't know if the way I said it was the right way or the wrong way.
But, you know, I think you don't have to apologize. I think people always know that you're trying to be respectful. That's as best as you can do.
Yeah.
I think you always do a great job. Regarding who? Egle. Oh!
Egle. I said Agle. Egle. Agle. That's Agle. The thing. Because you said Egle.
Agle.
Agle. I'm sorry.
We're probably still saying it wrong.
No, so. And when I refer... Well, like when I say something regarding, I don't know, I see a story that she posted or the book or something like that and I tell you, I always overthink the name.
Yeah.
Because I'm like, in my Colombian brain, I read it one way.
I'm sure she hears Egle
sorry.
So she's totally fine with that.
So
I'm positive.
Egle.
Oh, so we get...
was saying, hi, Nicolas and Dani. Thank you so much for the books. So exciting and such an amazing gift to us. Oh, that's so nice. No, because she was saying this, I think, before Sean was here.
Oh, no way.
So let me see if Agle, Sean...
If you're here...
We're interested in your book.
Yeah, please let everyone know.
Oh, please, yeah.
Yeah, this is a novel that Agle is publishing. So
yes.
We can...
plug it.
We can plug it here, yeah.
For sure.
Yeah, of course.
Yes. So...
And for us across the Atlantic, like what would be our best option to get it?
So when you were talking about paper, painting on paper,
yes.
Victor Sanchez was saying hot press or cold press paper.
This one, the moleskin one, I don't think it's quite hot pressed. If I have to be super honest, I'm not entirely sure because they don't say it, but I don't. Yeah, I don't think they quite specify.
Let's see. Gade Gaby, cuando dijimos que los libros iban a estar disponibles indefinidamente,
sí.
Dijo, excelente.
Muy amable.
Excelente. Gil was saying, oh, thank you. I was about to ask that. Hi, guys. Hey, Giu, how are you? Syndrome was saying, hello, always excited to see you paint.
Thank you.
Bartlomiech de Bosch was saying, I wish to get my hands on any of your books ever since I found OPL. This is such a nice thing you did. Bundle is very nicely priced. And a heart emoji.
Thank
you. Convinced me to return to PayPal. LOL. Thank you so much, Bartlomiech, and we hope you enjoy the book and everyone that gets it or them mm-hmm. enjoys it or them.
Okay, that was more complicated.
Henry Downs was saying, hey, appreciate you, inspiration, love
thank
it.
Thank you. Very kind.
Sean Farley was
Sean.
Saying, I'm doing great. I've been lurking on your recent streams and was answering. Agles. What's wrong with me, Agles?
I mean, don't get me started, but
No. It's the chair. Book. I have pre-ordered the Kindle version at Amazon. And I've told her she owes me a signed copy.
Oh, great.
I'm sure she will send you one, too. I got to take her author photo the day after quarantine ended in April.
Oh, no way. That's
so
cool.
That's so cool. Yeah.
Yeah. That's awesome. Yeah, I don't do ebooks. So, yeah, I really need that physical copy.
Let's see.
This coming from the person that is asking people if they could, like, generously buy our ebooks.
No, but I mean, we have art ebooks.
Yeah. I'm just
so
not an e-reader,
different.
I would say.
Yeah. And I think that also has to do with the fact that we don't have like a Kindle or something like
also,
that.
Also, yeah, we don't do that.
Wishlist 011 was saying downloading the bundle now.
No way.
Need
thank
to make
you.
Some space on my studio walls for some of these. Someone
oh,
else's
thank you.
Painting will have to come down
oh,
and a happy
that's...
face. Oh.
But I mean,
we're
you
happy
feel bad.
you're getting the bundle. Margarita Neves was saying, oh, so I already read that. It was about the getting the book in euros.
Yes.
Which is
No. It'll be in
very,
your currency.
Yeah, it's possible.
So
in
how
every
we offer
currency.
It is in US dollars. The prices that we just gave were in US dollars.
Let's see. So then we had all the chair conversation. So Shannon Hagen was saying, haha, Danny, look at barrier, that's it, balance. Let's see. Maybe it's another reference, a more affordable one. Is that the one you have, Shannon?
Shannon, could we not do the enabling on this on this stream? Thank you.
So it has,
oh God, look
like
at that
the Hag Capisco. It has the thing on the arms. Is that the one you have?
Oh, what is that?
How much
thing?
Is it?
I just turned my head to look at that thing.
I want to know how much is it.
That's like a gynecologist chair. That's if a gynecologist.
Have you been to a gynecologist?
Super familiar. That's like that has like stirrups. That's if you know who would be super comfortable, a gynecologist going to a gym. That would be the chair that a you know.
Well, I mean, for starters, if you think you sit at the gynecologist, that
it
says a lot.
It has stirrups.
So I'm sorry.
It has stirrups. That's all I see.
An
exam could take place on this chair.
It looks very cool. I think it's still out of my budget. It's $900.
Yeah, and you need a doctor degree. You need to be a doctor.
Let's see. So Patrick Hale was saying, what would you say to a person who is working professional doing illustration in digital painting, but what he really wants to do is painting, more fine arts, but needs to pay the bills?
Oof.
But what he really wants to do is painting more fine arts, but he needs to pay the bills and have two kids.
Oh.
Do you guys think I should go for it or keep it safe?
Oh, so you're describing me. So I graduated an illustrator. I love illustration, actually. That's, you know, how I understand myself, really, still very much so as an illustrator. Did as best as I could and gave myself the best chance I could to be an illustrator in New York. And it worked for a couple of years, I would say. It worked for like around 4 years. I wouldn't say it's a long, like illustrious career in illustration, but it was, you know, it was what was giving me enough money because it was paying for my rent and it was helping me save money. So it was more money than I needed when I was working as an illustrator, to be perfectly honest. And I was able to live in a kind of cool apartment. It was big enough. Sad thing for me was that I could only paint on weekends. So it really felt like I was sacrificing the thing that I loved to do, which was be a painter. It was becoming super obvious with the passing of the years that I was painting less and less and less and less. And I think I can't tell you what to do, because I don't think I'm in a position to understand your priorities or your needs. But I am a person. I am exactly the person that you describe. Like, I am an illustrator. I have always loved painting. I've always understood myself as a painter. I have two kids. So I understand what it means to, like, you know, kind of like blindly work for other people, and you put their priorities first and their needs first. And, you know, I understand that. I really, really do. And it's I also understand how that generates like a very scary sort of outlook on life. Like you always have to seek things that are safe. And it almost inadvertently drives you away from anything that is, you know, that is essentially taking chances. Like if it's not something that it's a sure bet, you just don't want to hear it. And you always keep repeating to yourself, well, I have two kids. I can't just gamble my kids', you know, life and my kids', you know, sort of balance. Just because I have a caprice, just because I have this whim that tells me that I can be a painter. And I'll say this, I think that in my life, it worked. It worked when I said, I want to take a chance on doing something different. Like, for example, I was a teacher for many years. And it was a bad job, but it was a stable job, or at least it was seemingly a stable job, because I actually had to sign a contract like every semester. So it was ridiculous. There was actually I couldn't be dependent on the university at all. So there was this illusion of that symbolizing stability. But at least I convinced myself that it was my job. Like, I have two kids. I have to take care of them. You know, this is as stable a job as I'm ever going to get, because what job does a painter get that is, like, stable, like, fully stable, right? So I convinced myself that I had to fight for that job, and I had to try to keep that job, and I kept it for 12 years, and it paid horribly, but I always convinced myself that was the price of stability, you know, just a bad paycheck year after year after year. And it was only, and I have to say this, like when I met Danny, that I was willing to accept that the job was just a bad job. It wasn't like a stable, nice job. I mean, the nice things about being a teacher were all things that had to do with just being a teacher,
mm-hmm.
like the core values of being a teacher, which are wonderful, I feel, and the opportunity that you have as a human being to, in my case, to share a lot of my life with young artists, which are like this, you know, ball of energy and courage, and they take risks, and it's amazing. Like that is, if we didn't need money, that is pay enough. You know, as an artist, that was pay enough for sure. If there was no, if I didn't have to pay bills and I didn't have any sort of economic responsibilities, oh my God, being a teacher is one of the most beautiful things that could ever happen to me, that could have ever happened to me. But it was also a horrible job. So I had to come to terms with that, with accepting that it was indeed a terrible job. And then with Danny, we sort of devised like a plan. It was in essence like a long kind of, you know, term plan. So it wasn't anything that was for sure going to work, and it was a gamble. But in my mind, I realized like, if I'm willing to go through this, it's because it's that important to mm-hmm. me.
And so, let's say that, I'm sorry.
No, go ahead.
That when we took that decision, we each had a tiny, but a safety net.
Yeah.
Yeah.
A little bit. Yeah, a little bit.
Because we knew that we were going to gamble in that decision.
Yeah. So we had some sort of leeway, but it was something that when we started our channel, it was something that could have gone sideways. Like, you know, there's nothing, absolutely nothing that guarantees that you're going to do well. Nothing. And our channel depended not on views, but on people purchasing the work that we did. So this is ridiculous. Like, if you really think about it, it's like, okay, come on, dude. Like, that's selling art. It's not easy. Like, trust me, I've sold a ton of artwork, and it's not easy. It's never easy. Never, ever, ever. So, you know, it was literally the biggest gamble that I could make in my life. But I was thinking, wow, if I'm not even willing to negotiate the fact that I need to do this, knowing that I'm responsible for my kids, it's because this is very important for me. Like, that's what I understood. Instead of being super scared, and instead of viewing it from the angle of saying, like, I can't do this, I'm responsible for my kids, period.
Yeah.
I need safe things. I started noticing that, wow, how desperate do I need to be to really consider this, like, really, really emotionally, and, you know, even with, like, a sort of calm brain, consider this, when for a fact I know that I am responsible for my kids. So that's not going to change. So how much do I need this as a human being if my body and my brain and my heart is telling me that I need to do this?
Mm-hmm.
And for me, that I started, like, trusting that more than just the fear of thinking, this is not going to work, I'm going to lose everything, and I'm gambling with my kids, again, with my kids' stability. I just, that thought didn't, I mean, I'm not going to say it didn't enter my brain, but I just didn't let it take over my brain.
Yeah.
And I'm
sorry. No, I was going to say that I also remember the many conversations we had, that it was also like a very decisive thing.
Mm-hmm.
The fact that the job at the university was terribly paid.
Oh, yeah.
Because you were super scared to leave that. But I remember once that you told me, okay, but I'm terrified to leave this, but this isn't giving me enough. So
no.
It's not like I'm losing a terrible, like a super stable and super good amount of money.
No, it was just an illusion of that.
But it was like your illusion of a safety, like of something safe you had.
Yeah.
But it was never enough.
No.
So I think that...
And when we say enough, is that... When Danny says it's not enough, it's not because you're just like yearning or wanting of more. It's just
like,
because
actually,
yeah, it was just wasn't enough to pay the things that I needed to pay.
Yes.
Like, I would need to not only work there every day of the week, and I was a thesis advisor for almost every semester that I was there in the university.
And you were there every day.
Yeah, so I was there every day, and then I would have to rush back and paint, and I would have to sell the paintings that I would paint.
Yes.
Just to make up for the money that I wasn't earning at the university.
So the work that you had was like occupying the majority of your time, but it was giving you a less income that what you had to do in the little spare time you had,
yes,
which was painting.
Oh, yeah.
So it was also like the balance was, it was not okay.
No, it was over. I was overworking myself to the bone, like dry, I would say.
Yes.
And again, for an illusion of stability, because it was never there. It was never, ever there. Like I could convince myself that it was there, but it was never there, trust me. So I could totally understand if people that are, like, let's say freelance illustrators, they say, well, no, this is my thing, or no, this is what I'm kind of used to, or I've built my life around this. Like, you can find, and I'm not saying this is your case, but you can find a ton of excuses that make you believe that, sure, that's something that you can rely upon. But if you maybe, or at least I'm going to say in my case, I don't want to speak for anyone here, but in my case, when I took a step back, I was like, really? Is this really as good as I think it is? Or am I just, like, afraid to confront how bad this thing is for me? And when I confronted it, I realized, oh no, it is not good. It is really not good. So that gave me clarity too. The fact that I was giving up something that was objectively not good for me. And I think then what happened afterwards was just full commitment. Because I do think that you need a plan. Because we weren't, like, when we decided to do what we were gonna do, it wasn't like from 1 month to the next, we're going to be like, okay, now we start doing this. No. It actually took, I would say we talked about it and we designed everything maybe 8 months before we started.
I would even say more.
Yeah.
Because we started having serious conversations about it maybe 8 months before. But even like a year before it, we started having conversations around that.
And like serious conversations.
And how we had to like start, like we had to start planning
sort of
ahead of time.
Yeah, adjusting things ahead
exactly.
of time.
Exactly. So, for example, I had a different job.
Yeah.
So I quit that job.
Yeah.
So you had already quit the job you had.
Yeah.
And we were just like trying to set up something that would work for you and for me.
Yeah.
And just like have a very good plan of what are we going to do? How are we going to price what we do?
Yeah.
Like
how much work we immediately understood how much work was needed to do what we were going to try to do.
Yeah.
Which was a ton of work. And we were both willing to go through that.
And we even realized like it was more work convinced. Than when we that what we thought.
Yeah.
Which was already a lot of work.
Yeah. It was tough.
Yeah.
Like it was really, really tough. But we also had this, and I think this was super, super important. We spoke about it and we were convinced that regardless of how we did, we would keep doing it.
Yeah.
So we were like, you know, if in this first month we sell nothing and it's terrible and nobody's watching this, we keep going.
We have to find a way to keep going.
We keep going.
And
keep
it wasn't
going.
Like
that's,
we
that's
had
the...
an amazing safety net and we were like, oh, we can keep going. No.
No,
we
you
would
start
be
seeing
like
your savings just, you know, get smaller and smaller and smaller very quickly.
Yeah. But we were very committed to
it.
Like, and also I...
blindly, like regardless, like if one people sees the video, we still do the videos. And we still talk to people as if there were 1,000 people watching watching us at that moment. Like we had to. And if we didn't sell the painting, we kept going as if every single painting was sold. It was obvious that we couldn't fake it because our store was going to be there and people could see the paintings that were sold and the paintings that hadn't sold. So it wasn't about, because I absolutely abhor this saying, this thing, that the fake it until you make it. I've never understood what that means. That's a load of bullshit, if you ask me. If you're a painter, you need to be vulnerable. You need to recognize what you need to work on. And then you need to work hard. Like you need to work intelligently and you need to work in a committed way and you need to work really, really hard. And so we weren't going to lie about it. So if there was 20 paintings, 30 paintings in our webpage and none of them had sold, we kept going. Like I told Danny, we keep going.
Until we can't.
Yeah, we are like the only two people that have to believe that what we're doing is what we want to do. Like that is exactly what we want to do. If we don't believe in it, nobody else will.
Yeah, another thing that I would say that was important for the decision you took of quitting your job and later on the decision we had for creating our painted lives, it was the fact that, as we were saying, you were teaching, but you were also selling paintings. It wasn't like you were gonna just like jump into the
ether.
Ether?
Well, you could say that. You could say it like that.
Like you were gonna
take
do
a
like a blind leap.
Yeah, leap of faith.
Yeah, into selling when you had never sold anything, or
right.
you had never paint, or you were never like in a Yeah, like in an art market, because I think that was also something you knew,
right?
And you were doing simultaneously
yes.
as you were teaching.
Yes.
So again, when you just took a step back, you were like, well, what I'm going to do is just take away this part of my life, which occupies a lot of time and doesn't pay back a lot.
At all.
And I'm going to, And I'm going to concentrate in this thing that I'm already doing.
Yeah.
And I'm going to like focus all my energy into this.
Yes.
And that was what you thought. And then we decided to create something where we both could just like put all of our energy into it.
Yeah. There's like a simplicity to it when there's no other option, when there's like no plan B, it's actually kind of cool. I mean, it's not for everyone. This kind of like blind sense of commitment that Danny was speaking about is very scary, but it's also very liberating because you have one option and you're just going to work, you know, you're just going to put everything into that one option.
And let's say that it can go amazing, but you also have to know that it can go bad. Like bad in the fact that maybe it doesn't give you what you were looking for, and maybe you have to like start looking something else. But I think the important thing is to know that you gave your 1000% to that thing that you were committed to. Because if you enter something or if you start a project of whatever you want to do, but you start doubting about yourself, like if you doubt about yourself doing something, of course everyone's going to doubt because you're not even sure about what you're doing. But if you're like super committed and you say, you know what, I'm going to do this and it's going to be a lot of work and it's going to be complicated and I'm scared, but I'm going to stick to it. And as Nicolas was saying, it's not like I posted one thing, it hasn't sold. No, I'm going to change this. You know what? I want my job back. No, like you have to stick to the decision you take, whatever it is.
Yeah.
I think that's just like the best way to make changes in your, like in your work. So
it's very scary, but I don't think it's ever not going to be scary. And especially with art. Especially with art. I mean, anyone that tells you that there are safer ways to transition to things in art, it's all bullshit. I'm sorry, but it's all bullshit.
Or
it's
maybe they were just very lucky, which also happens because sometimes you just listen to the successful stories about someone that got into the gallery that they loved when they were just studying in the university, and you think that that's going to happen to you. Or like if you follow their steps, you're going to be there in 2 years, 3 years. And it's not the same for everyone.
No.
So yeah, it is very important to know that it can happen and you should give it your 1000%, but not because you give it your 1000%. It means it is going to happen.
Oh, there's no guarantees. Like in art, there's absolutely no guarantees whatsoever. You could, I mean, let's say you're successful and you, whatever that means, and you know, or let's try to define that. Let's say you've been showing paintings in galleries for 10 years and you've done well and you've worked for a show for over a year and a half or 2 years so that you can have a one-person show once again. Not all the sales of your previous, you know, shows and your previous paintings combined will ever guarantee that on the next show you're going to do well. So you're always risking those 2 years that you have worked super hard, you know, again, blindly hoping that you can, you know, that you can receive like critical acclaim and that you can sell out your show. And because you need it, right? Because you've worked for 2.5 years. So it's not that you just want to sell a painting, is that you want to make up the 2 years that you have already invested on making those paintings. So there's never a guarantee, never, ever a guarantee in art. And once you sort of accept that and you go like, okay, this is always horrible. There's always going to be a reason to fear things. In art, always, there's never going to be job security. I my heart breaks. Like I've been so like enchanted and enamored looking at all the previous work that the artists that all these amazing artists have done for. And it's funny because it's a bunch of them have worked for both the Spider-Verse Across the Spider-Verse movie and the Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles Mayhem movie. There's a lot of like people that have done jobs for both movies, and they're so incredible. But if you talk to these incredible artists, these super, super talented artists that feel safe when they're working on a big production, but then, you know, feel immediately unsafe because they don't know what the next sort of big project is. They don't know if the studio is gonna, you know, just cut down on jobs because they need to go smaller. They have no idea. They have absolutely no idea if they're gonna be needed. So even in those moments where people do amazing jobs, because they do, I mean, it's such an incredible, incredible amount of talent. Like that pool of talent that is in those movies is just, I mean, it lifts your spirit to see so many talented people working in those industries. But if you ask them, there's nothing safe about their job.
No,
like you could have been part of, like, Across the Spider-Verse was like commercially incredibly successful. I think their box office, yeah, it's grossing like $680 million, $690 million, which is great, which is absolutely fantastic for a movie like that. And still, there's a lot of people that would tell you, like, oh yeah, I did great on that movie, but then they let me go. And then it was super hard finding another job.
Yeah, because I was going to say that I feel that, I mean, every job that's art-related, or the majority of jobs that are art-related, have that, like, instability thing.
Oh, it's built, like, into it, yeah.
Because, let's say, I mean, in your case, you decided that you wanted to quit teaching, and you decided that. But in, like, it could have been that the university decided that they didn't want you anymore.
Yeah.
If you decided, you know what, I want to stay in the university. And maybe they were like, you know, we're changing our teachers, so we don't need you anymore. Thank you.
Yeah.
And you would be in the same position that you were. But the thing is that you took the decision.
Yeah.
Like you made that decision. So I think that happens a lot in the art world, that sometimes you feel that you have something that is very stable, but as we were saying, sometimes it's not. It doesn't mean it is going to be stable always.
No.
If it is stable today.
No, that's
so
sadly that's not the nature of our work. You know, it's very, I guess, discouraging if you're looking at it from the outside in, but that is the nature of what we do. And what's even sadder is that they sort of present it as a huge gamble. Like, galleries will gamble on your work. They'll take a chance on you if you're like this young, you know, and by young, I mean like you could be middle-aged, but you're young in terms of being a professional artist,
yeah.
Or yeah. You're like your career had just started. So galleries are like, we're taking a chance on you. Like, we're speculating on you. And it's always based on this notion that you have the potential of hitting it big. You have the potential of at some point just becoming, you know, famous like Damon Hirst. So, you know, that is, you know, the sacrifices that you do are so that you can maybe at some point, it almost sounds like a Hollywood actor, this thing. Like, maybe at some point you get hired for this movie and you're discovered. And then you're going to make $20 million a movie. And then, you know, all these years of being like a waitress and having shitty jobs and, you know, couch surfing. And it's all going to be worth it. It doesn't matter. It never mattered, because it was all worth it because you made it. There's always that dumb, stupid promise in the art world. And I hate it. I hate it, because that's what takes away from the fact that the wealth in galleries, and I guess you're seeing exactly the same thing with like studios, with production studios and you know, these bigger corporations. Like, the wealth could be better spread. A gallery doesn't immediately need to, so that they can blow you up as an artist, immediately need to sell your work for hundreds of thousands of dollars when they were selling it for tens of thousands. Mm. Like, it doesn't need to happen that abruptly, that quickly. But the thing is, when a gallery sees the opportunity to do that, they just pounce on it because they're going to make a ton of money. But the reality is, like, if there was a market that was willing to spend, let's say, you know, during that month, they were able to get sales for like, I don't know, $1 million in that one show, why don't they convince like the market, their audience to be like, you know what? Instead of buying like these 10 paintings for $100,000 each of this one person, let me introduce you to more artists and maybe we can sell 100 paintings for $10,000. And maybe that's, you know, galleries could work that way. But no, they just always want to take advantage of that one kind of golden apple and then let it rot because it's useless for them. And then they'll go searching for that other person.
Yeah, and I was going to say that's also the complicated thing because I think that sometimes when big galleries get an artist, they think they've made it.
Yeah.
And the sad thing about that is that they've made it if the gallery wants them to make it.
Oh, yeah.
Because
that's
if they decide,
decision.
You know, it's been 5 years, but we kind of don't vibe with them anymore, then they're just going to throw that person out. And the value that they, like, that now they sell for, the prices they sell for, they can't sell anymore if they don't have, like, those galleries protecting them and, like, pushing them to sell more.
Yeah, so, and then you're gonna be considered a failure because, oh, that was that person that was selling for $100,000 last, you know, 6 months ago, and now they can't give the paintings away, and now it's been 2 years, and the paintings are back down to $20,000 because they weren't able to sell anything. It's like, oh God, red flags. That's terrible. Don't ever invest on this artist. It's a horrible model. It's a horrendous, horrendous model. It's meant to like cannibalize artists. It's meant to be only taken advantage, you know, by those initial investors and those gallery directors that push certain artists. I mean, he is incredibly talented. I'm going to talk about Salman Tour. He's incredibly
talented.
So
yeah.
Let's start there, just by stating that he is a fantastic artist. But I was showing Danny the Sotheby's, all the Sotheby's sale that he had in his auction when his pieces were being auctioned off. And they were hoping to get, let's say, £100,000, £200,000. And they were going for, £700,000-£800,000, £900,000. Some of them went past £1 million, which is insane. Which is absolutely insane. Salman Tour, could you give me the what year is he born?
1983.
83. So for an artist to go past a million, I know that before, you know, Saatchi, it was, you know, Lucian Freud would sell for $1 million. Then, you know, these young British artists came around and Saatchi was like pushing all these artists. And they started selling for over $1 million when they were in their 30s, you know, but they were like, there was a huge mechanism just trying to build these people up. And that's how you got, you know, Damon Hirst and eventually like Jenny Saville or Cecily Brown, you know, artists like that. But, you know, to see it nowadays, again, with somebody who's very talented, very, very talented, but to see the expected market price. And then just for no damn reason, because there's no damn reason. I mean, if you told me that one of his paintings was worth £150,000, I would be like, oh my God, that's pricey, but that's sure. I guess he deserves that. That's fine. But if you start seeing consistently how all these lots sold for like, you know, hundreds and hundreds of thousands of pounds more than their expected price.
I mean, this one, I have this one. It's called Four Friends. And it was estimated to go for $300 to $400. $400,000.
I'll buy it.
Yeah.
Which is a ridiculous amount of money, by the way.
$300,000 to $400,000.
It's an insane amount of money.
And it was sold for $1,562,000.
That's absurd. That's 500% over the $300,000 mark.
As you're saying, it's crazy.
That's something that's not. It just can't be. That just can't be the rule of how our market is defined. And I know that a lot of you would say like, oh no, but that's still like big leagues. That's big leagues. That's not us. That's none of that actually affects us. Oh, you're very wrong. All of it affects us. Like it trickles down, and the push that those galleries make, the model that those galleries have, the bigger galleries have, tries to be echoed by every single gallery that is of a lower tier and a lower tier and a lower tier. You know, they always want to do that. If given the chance, there's not a single gallery that would say, oh no, I'm not gonna, you know, potentially overprice this and then make, you know, hundreds of thousands of dollars off of this artist. And then, you know, have no remorse about them being like, you know, thrown under the bus when you don't need them anymore. Because you don't push like a single artist. Novelty is always the thing that you want. You always want to say, oh, do you want to invest on somebody who's going to become enormous? And people, you know, all these wide-eyed investors go like, oh, yes, of course. So they need somebody who's new constantly, constantly.
But also it's like, of course it's a trap because it's like, oh, this artist might sell a lot. It's when big galleries say that, I mean, when like the big guns of art say that, is because they've already decided that artist is going to make it. Because those like big heads of art never gamble because they are the ones that create the rules.
Of course.
The ones that gamble are the artists that are like in that mix and the little galleries, because the big galleries would never like lose on that game.
No.
It's their game.
And you know who loses? The idiots that come in late.
Yeah.
They always lose because the people that come in early, when they tell these people.
But they come early because they are contacted.
So the gallery director says, let's not use Gagosian and, you know, his girlfriend as an example because we don't want to.
So let's say that someone says that I'm going to be.
Let's use Danny. Yeah.
Yeah. Chili is going to be.
Chili. Gagosian meets Chili.
Well, that would never go bad.
Gagosian meets Chili and he's like, David Zwirner meets Chili. And Zwirner goes like, I fucking love this Chili. I love it. She's got it.
You know, Gagosian, I got that.
She's got it.
I get
no, we went with Zwirner.
Zwirner. Yeah, everyone
Gagosian
would love.
Already has like, you know.
Everyone would love Chili.
Interest.
But.
So, and they say, you know what? Let's do a show with Chili. We can't just like introduce her to the market at like insane prices. So let's introduce Chili to the market at a reasonable price. So prices would be, let's say reasonable prices for a high-end gallery would be like, they'll do a painting and it's like $20,000, $30,000. So they sell out because Zwirner tells everyone, Chili is going to be good. Trust me, Chili is going to be good. So you get 20 people that buy 20 paintings for $30,000 each. And they go like, okay. And sometimes it's not even 20 people. Sometimes there's like, you know, groups of people that just pool their money and say like, oh, we got to put $5,000 into this and we'll have like a Chili painting. Fine. You know, sometimes they buy stocks. Sometimes they buy Jordans. Sometimes they buy old vintage video games that are boxed and minted. Or sometimes they buy paintings. You know, there's
Chili
tons
paintings.
Of people out there that invest money like that. So they buy a Chili painting. And then, you know, Zwirner tells them, don't worry, I got you. I got you. Because the next round of investors, you know, they're going to see a show, but the paintings are not $30,000. They're now $100,000 each. And they're going to go like, $100,000? Really? And, you know, the curator, bought curator, and the director, you know, that obviously this is like absurd because he has absolute interest in trying to inflate these works. They're going to say, you know what? Chili's selling everything. She's amazing. She blew up. She's incredible. Everyone loves her. So now, of course, yeah, the market is saying that her work is now $100,000. You should get in. You should get in at $100,000. So now the secondhand investors go like, okay, I'll pay $100,000. Now the happiest ones are the ones that bought it for 30, because they bought it for 30, but now there's idiots that are paying 100 for that. So now they're saying like, okay, we just tripled the price of this in 2 years. That's crazy. You know, what else can you invest anything where you get, you know, triple, where you get to triple your investment in 2 years, in 3 years? It's insane. So people are like, this is incredible. This is absolutely incredible. But then the director goes like, we sold out the show of the 100,000.
I had to move the camera so people could
see. I found even more idiots for that show. So now we have, you know, 20 more people that were willing to pay $100,000. So now we have a bunch of these idiots, but we're going to make a bunch of these idiots happy. So we're going to take our paintings. Now, Chili is like well known and recognized because she's been pushed by these galleries, and she has like good reviews in whatever, you know, art critic magazine that values any of that bullshit. But and now they're going to say, you know what? She's young, but we can take her to Sotheby's. We can take her to an auction house and just really see how far we can push these prices. So now what happens? Paintings that were 100 grand, like Salman Tours, suddenly are sold for 800,000, you know, $1 million, on the promise that Chili is going to keep growing, because people are like, are you kidding me? She went from 20 to 50 to 100 to now the auction to 800,000. I got to get in. Like, this is, you know, this is safe money. When in truth, it's not. It was just meant to make the people that were starting out in this pyramid, you know, make them a lot of money. The people that were starting, you know, the initial investors are the happiest. The initial investors eventually paid 30 for something that was then pushed to 100 and that was then pushed to 800,000. So who would not want to go from 30 to 100 to 800? It's nothing. There's no market that gives you like that sort of like a clean, crisp road to producing, to having your money produce so much, you know, aside from the art market. There's nothing like it. It doesn't exist. And it doesn't exist because it's controlled by the people who actually affect that market, which is insane. They have like a direct way to affect a market. So we're talking about this, and why are we talking about this? Because if you ever think that there is a sense of security in the art world, even at its highest, even at the highest tiers of the art world and the art market, there is none. There is none. It's always this shifting fucking quicksand pit that changes constantly based on, you know, what rich people want. And if they decided it was you, then you consider yourself lucky, but you also consider that you have to consider that this could be a very short ride. Like, they could forget about you instantly, and you should, you know, count your blessings, and you should manage your money properly, because
your money, which is crazy important in those cases.
Yeah,
I
but
feel.
Because just like that, they could tell you like, nah, you're not relevant anymore. You're not. Nobody cares about what you do anymore. I'm sorry. We moved on. We need a new face. We just need a new face. It's not fun to just say, because you peak at something, right? You can't just say it's always just $1 million. Oh, it's $1 million and $1 million. Because now people are not going to make money off it, if you think about it. So if Chili sold the auction at $1 million, she has to come out and keep selling at $1 million, right? It's like, that's her price now. That's what the market demanded the price to be. But you can't move. Chili can't do another show and then suddenly everything is like 2.5 million, 3 million. No. There's no market for that anymore.
Well, she could.
Well, Chili could. Yeah. If there's anyone that could, Chili could.
Yeah.
Right? So every 2 years, she can't be like two millions more expensive. No, of course not. She has to plateau. It just has to happen. So they don't care for an artist that plateaus and you just sell for $1 million, because they're not making money off of selling it for $1 million. You know, they can't make more money, you know, when selling for $1 million. They love to just turn things that are like a couple of $10,000 into $1 million. That's what they love to do. They adore that. And they can find a ton of investors to do that constantly. But selling something for $1 million, that's not an easy sell. Selling, you know, constantly things for 2.5 million, that's insane. That's not easy. There's no market. There's no big market for that. So they have to, what do? They start again. They just say, okay, let's pick somebody else. It's crazy. It's crazy. But as soon as you accept that that is the reality of our world, like the world that we chose as artists, there's tons of decisions that become super clear. Like for us, it was saying, we don't want to be a part of that. Like we don't. We want to, even if it's a tiny, even if we create this minuscule, like this market that you can't even see under a microscope, we want it to be ours because we can like take care of it. We can nurture it. And instead of just being beholden to somebody that can just throw you away at a moment's whim, you can say, you know what? I just don't want to be huge like that, but I want to be stable as can be, or as stable as something that I can control. And that's what we chose. We made a sacrifice to say, we're leaving sort of like the quote unquote big leagues to focus on something that we can control.
Yeah. And now again, of course, we're not saying that we were on the route to Sotheby's, because I think that
it's a long con, Danny. Sometimes, give us 5 years.
No, because I think that sometimes there's also a big mistake with people selling art. And it's that they say, you know what? I want that. I want that for me.
I want it.
And it's not something that you can just like be very like constant with your work and you're going to get there. It's not something you achieve, because again, it's like a lottery. They just pick someone.
Yeah.
So it's like if you say, you know what? I know what I want to do for my life. I'm going to win the lottery. It's like, oh, for sure. Like, try to do
good
it.
For you. Go. Yeah. Go crazy.
Like,
go nuts.
That's not having a plan. So I feel that sometimes, and at least that happened with some of my friends in the university when I was studying arts. I think that there were people that were like, you know, I want that for me. I want that for my life. And it's like, well, yeah, and I also want, again, as I was saying, the lottery, but that's not something you choose.
I want the stirrup
so
chair.
That's not having a plan.
Stirrup chair of the gyno...
Ecologist.
Yeah, gyno strongman.
Gynocherogist.
Yeah.
Yeah, so let's read some questions regarding that.
I always feel it's like kind of boring talk.
No,
and
but
it's sort
I
of iterative
so.
Talk. But it's a very real way of understanding, hey, when I step into this world, what am I stepping into? Mm-hmm. And it's not like, oh, I just like the corner, you know, store, gallery, and I'm always going to be fine with like maybe them selling my work for like $500 and I get $250. No, because at some point you're like, hey, I wish I could understand how it feels to live off of, to like actually make a living, to... Let's say if you want, I'm going to say whatever number, if you want $80,000 a year, what does that mean? Like, how many paintings do you have to sell so that you can have $80,000 a year? Like, how do you kind of like create a job that, or a model that involves a painting practice that can give you that? And as soon as you insert yourself into that world, you have to be aware of how it works.
Mm-hmm.
And how it works is just like, take a look at a big gallery and that's how it works.
Yeah, but I would also say, I mean, because this is all answering to Patrick's question. And at the end, we were talking about like the very real, but also very terrible
well,
reality of galleries. If you're not in that bubble, if in that like, super selective circle.
Yeah.
But I also think that, I mean, as we were saying, we decided to work as artists and to live of what we love.
Yeah.
And in our case, it translated into something different. But for us, it was completely worth it. So it's not like saying, I mean, we're not trying to like scare Patrick. Like, you know what? Stay in your work because the art world is terrible. No, it's just...
No, it
but
is
I think
what it
is. It is very important to not like fantasize about what it can be, but to really know what it is.
Yes.
And to really know what you're getting into. If you're selling by your own, or if you want to be in a gallery, or whatever the path you want to take, just know the facts about that path. Don't just like fantasize of how good it can be.
Right.
Because it also have a counterpart to that. So yeah, it's important to, with every decision that you're going to take, just like see the whole picture. And after you have the whole picture, decide if you want to get into that or not. So
yeah, because sometimes we say, and just jumping off of what you were saying, Danny, sometimes we say, no, the tough decision is just saying, I want to paint for a living now. Sure, that seems like a sensible, I think sensibly speaking, that seems like the tough decision, right? To say, you know what, I'm a painter. And I want to accept that I'm a painter and I'm going to paint for a living.
But there are variables
But then
you can't
then you
control.
Have to go like, okay, but how does a painter make a living? How do you make a living when you paint?
Yes.
And that should be your question. Like, and there's no one answer to this for sure. There's people that have made, you know, great models for themselves and have taken like completely different routes. But there's obviously like a working model, a bigger working model that involves, you know, socializing your work at a very large scale, let's say, with a large audience that maybe you have it's inaccessible to you, that has to do with galleries. That's just how things have worked for, you know, many, many years. And that's how things are going to continue to work, I feel. So you have to sort of be aware of what it means to say, I want to paint.
Mm-hmm.
I want to paint for a living. Like, that is going to be my life from now on. It's like, great. I love that you have faith on yourself as a painter. That's wonderful. But now let's see what that means. Like, what does that mean for you? Like, how are you going to plan paying for rent or mortgage or whatever, you know? How are you going to pay for, you know, your the whatever expenses your kids, you know, symbolize, your kids represent? Those things are very real. And then you say, you know, and you can say, you know what, I'm going to take care of sales myself, for example, which is a great we live at a time where there's a great opportunity to do those things by yourself, you know, to say, you know what, I'm going to grab my market by the horns and I'm just going to take control of it. Amazing. Nowadays, we live in a world where we can do that. But what does that mean? What does that mean, I'm going to control my own market? Is it easy? And let me tell you, quick answer, oh, it's not easy.
No.
It's
also,
not
again,
at all easy.
There's many variables that do not depend on you. It's not like you saying, you know what, I'm going to sell the things I do. Because I think the hard part there is that you have to create those things. So you have to put your time into creating those things. But then they have to sell. And that does not depend on you.
No, it could be the greatest paint. It could be best painting you've ever done.
Mm-hmm.
And then you go like, how do I price this? It's, you know, it's a painting that I've spent X amount of time on. Am I going to base my prices solely on how much time I've, you know, invested on each painting? Because that can be difficult, right? If, let's say again, if you were hoping to, let me have like a easier multiple of like 12. If you were hoping to make,
easier multiple.
Yeah, it's in my brain, it makes sense. If you were hoping to make $84,000, so that means making $7,000 a month, right? So instead of the 80 grand that I was saying at the beginning, you want to make $84,000. And that means that you have to make $7,000 a month. And let's say you've been painting a painting, and this is not weird. I used to do two large paintings a month. But let's say that you don't do two large paintings a month. You make one large painting a month. And I mean, it would be unadvisable for just to do that single painting a month, because that would be putting all your eggs under that, like on that one basket. But let's say you paint two. So you have two pieces, large pieces, that you can attempt to sell for, you know, $3,500 each, so that you can make the $7,000 that you need, so that you can make the $84,000 a year that you are hoping for. Now, if you went through a gallery, those $3,500 pieces, they would each have to go for $7,000 because galleries take 50%. So now you have to make sure that you sell two $7,000 paintings a month. Now, I shouldn't be the person to tell you that selling every single month for whatever many years you see as a foreseeable future, selling $7,000 $7,000 paintings a month for every month of the year for X number of years is an easy thing to do. It is not an easy thing to do. Just if you don't trust me, ask any gallery owner if it's easy to sell $7,000 paintings
and
consistently.
Also, if you create like a living around the budget and you just give for granted the fact, like if you think you're going to sell yes or yes that amount of money a month because that's what you need for a living, and maybe you don't sell it for a month, then like where are you going to get
that? Oh yeah, if you start lagging,
exactly.
If you start like saying, oh shit, this one didn't sell, but it's okay, I can try to make up for it next month.
And maybe you can say, okay, next month I'm not going to do two paintings, I'm going to like overwork and do three paintings.
Yeah, but then maybe
and then
one sells.
Two don't sell.
Yeah, maybe one of them sells, which is fine, which is absolutely fine, right?
Yeah.
If you do three paintings and one sells, it's fine. Let me tell you that. It is absolutely fine. Mm-hmm. But the model that we work on is so weird that it makes us feel like, fuck, I really needed to sell like almost 100% of my work to so that I could live the life that I think I deserve. It is very strange and very difficult. It is. It's just, it is what it is. It, you know, it's not, I don't know how it could be better. I mean, we visualize something that could be a little bit better, which is just something that has lower prices. And that's about it. But for us to...
But that also translated into a lot of work.
Yeah, for us to say, well, let's lower the price. And we would be like, great, let's lower the price. And that sounds amazing. Everyone loves it. It's like, oh, yes, lower price points. Awesome. Affordable. Awesome. But what does that mean? That you have to paint like crazy. Mm-hmm. You have to make tons of paintings.
Because
like,
then
tons.
It's not like, yes, I sold one. It's like, yes, I have to sell 10 or I have to sell 20 or I have
You know why that second book, that PDF that we're offering right now has 432 pages? Because it probably has within those pages around 420 paintings. And all of them we've been able to sell. So it is insane the amount of work that you have to do. It is absolutely insane to try to counterbalance, you know, the sort of natural tendency that a gallery has or that a market has to just say, we just need to ask for more money on this. Don't you worry. We'll just make the price higher so that you could do one painting. And then hopefully when we sell it, that'll give you a sense of like, you know, ease, and you can be, you know, you can sleep at night and you can say like, okay, I now have money for like 3 months or something like that. But it's an absurd model. It really is an absurd model. And it's, I would say that what we embarked on is not easier because it wasn't easier, but because it's the daily stress of trying to sell something, but at least it was something that we controlled.
Let's say it was like, it is a stressful decision still and like a stressful path, but it is at least the path, the stress that we decided to
that
embark
we chose.
On.
Exactly.
Yeah.
We chose
it's our stress.
We chose it. We picked the price point. Yeah. We said, like, we weren't overworked. You know, we weren't told to that you need to work weekends for, you know, 8-10 hours every weekend. Which is what we did. We worked weekdays and weekends.
8 or 10 hours a day.
And we were working
10
hours a day every single day.
Because even the weekend we were working.
Yeah, our weekends were terrible. If you don't believe us, ask my kids. Ask my kids how much they saw us work. Because that was the toughest part.
Yeah.
Ask them how much we worked. And
how
it is
we
a
would
huge
have
sacrifice.
To, like overwork in the week so we could have one day of going to see a movie with them.
Yeah.
So it sounds crazy, but it was like the decision we took. And that was the amount of work that we were having because of the decision we took. But as we said at the beginning, we stuck to that decision.
Yeah, that was our choice.
Yeah. Let's see. So there's a lot of comments here regarding the conversation. So Patrick Hale, who was the person who made the question.
Oh, Patrick is probably like, peace out, sorry. Yeah, sorry I brought this
chat.
Up. Sorry I brought this up. This is horrible.
No, Patrick was saying, thank you so much for the answer. I wish I was there talking to you guys. Haha.
Oh, you're here.
No, and Patrick, I mean, anything regarding this or whatever other topic that you would like to talk with us, please. I mean, we are here for this. So, let's see. Shannon Hagen was saying, were there times you found yourself struggling and doubtful? How did you support each other, if so? So I would say yes. And I would say that at the very beginning, so before taking the decision, I think it was the more, like, the biggest doubtful moment, at least in your case.
Oh, yeah.
There for each other. We were having like constant conversations.
Yeah.
And it was not a conversation like, no, you can do whatever you want to do and you're a bright star, I love you. No, it was like a real conversation. So if you really want to just do something else, let's brainstorm. Like, let's see pros and cons. Tell me, why are you scared or why would you like to take that risk? And I think it's not something you have to do with someone else, but you could do with yourself. Because we did it with each other, but we also did it for ourselves. Like,
yes.
Asking all those questions that we've been saying, because it is very important to, like, to know the reality of the decision you're going to take. So,
yeah.
And I would say, I mean, when they were saying struggling and doubtful, there's been moments that we've been like that, but I feel that, I mean, it sounds maybe a little bit cheesy, but the thing I love about working with Nicolas in our Painted Lives is that I feel that we are like a little motor and we are both like engines and we just, like, we know what we're doing and we know the motion we have to have for it to work.
Yeah.
So I'm always thinking about things we could do for our Painted Lives to work, and you're doing the same thing. So I feel that for us, it is very important to be like in the same wavelength,
yeah,
of the things we are doing. So I think that that helps us a lot because we know it is a ton of work, but we have each other's back. So
yeah, it certainly makes it easier, mm-hmm, having just somebody who you are very in tune with. And the fact that we...
Oh, Chile.
Sorry, Chile. Don't eat the paint. Don't eat the paint.
I think there's like, there's going to be like a little paw.
Yeah, paint. Yeah, yeah. So you're getting a Chile signature. So I think David Zwirner is going to be happy.
So
with
this is the million dollar painting.
Yeah, with the price of this painting. Yeah, don't eat the paint, Chile. Don't give me that scare.
And she...
Stay still.
That was like a big jump.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
She was like, I'm gonna eat it.
Well, she's been...
It
she's
looks
been
like
the,
toilet paper.
She's been the critic for the past couple of paintings. So she's like, okay, let me see what we are dealing with today.
Chili.
Let me see.
No, we can't see her there.
Let me see.
We can see her back.
Terrible. She side-eyed me, so yeah. I gotta work on it.
So... J.E., the lone wanderer, was saying, you stop being an artist the moment it becomes mechanical. Catherine Peremski was saying, this conversation brings up a question I'm grappling with. Painting things that are meaningful for me or what I know will sell. And Catherine was saying, I have a mini solo show right now and 3 paintings sold at the opening. Oh, congratulations, Catherine.
Awesome.
I'm also excited, obviously. But 2 were of little dogs. Maybe I should only paint chihuahuas for now on. That would not be the worst existence. I think that would be amazing. But regarding the question, painting things that are meaningful for me or what I know will sell, I think you have an experience with that, with
I
what
would
you
say,
were selling.
Yeah, I would say, Catherine, so I don't know if this is what you're hinting at, but Catherine, I would say how do you know if things are going to sell? First of all,
yeah, first of
like,
all,
how do you know? You never know. I've sold things that I was like, okay, this is a painting where I took like a ton of chances. This is ridiculous. Nobody's going to like this. And it sells immediately. And then I've worked on paintings that I'm like, okay, this is my bread and butter. People eat this up. I'm just going to, you know, I'm going through a moment where I'm a little confused about myself and insecure about my work, my practice. I'm just going to go to my old faithful and I'm just going to do the paintings that I know I can just do these in my sleep. And I'm going to sell this and it'll give me like stability for the next couple of months, let's say. And then I'm going to try to get out of that rut, you know, with just like that, the ease of knowing that I sold the painting. Catherine, I've done those paintings and they don't sell. They never sold. And I'm like, are you fucking kidding me? Like, I thought this was a sure sale. Mm-hmm. Like, what's going on? And it just, it really just racks your brain because you start kind of like noticing that there is no way to predict things that are seemingly as easily predictable as those things, right? As saying like, well, I've sold 10 of these before. I'm surely going to sell this one.
Mm-hmm.
That doesn't mean anything. It really, really doesn't mean anything. Unless you have like a gallery owner that tells you like, you know what? There's like 30 people in line. I've already received money from them. Like you just paint tons
they're
of these.
They're sold.
And there's
even
like,
before
they are
painted,
sold. Yeah. These are like easy. These are cake to sell. Don't worry about it. Like my job is super easy when you paint those. Like if that's the case, sure. But when it's not as obvious as that, I would say just always go with what is meaningful. Always, always go for what is meaningful. I always think that sincerity in art is the thing that will always, always be a constant regardless of a market. Like when you spot something that is sincere, when you spot like a story that can only be told because it belongs to somebody, because it's meaningful to somebody, when you see it as a human being, you go like, oh, that is cool. And that is cool not because somebody decided that it was going to be cool and expensive. No, that is something that's meaningful because it speaks to us at a, you know, more human level. So I would always say those are the paintings that you need to be faithful to.
Yeah.
And those are the ones that you can always rely upon and you can always be proud of yourself for doing. That I would say is something that if in doubt, I would always, always fall back on those sort of paintings. Always. Like there's nothing in this world that could convince me that those paintings, even if they're hard to sell, don't have an enormous value on us as human beings and the way we communicate with each other and the things that we want to transmit to each other. Like I would go for those for sure. The other ones are just like, they seem like easy bets. They seem like, okay, this is like easy peasy. I paint my peonies and I know that I can sell them. I got a whole market of like retired ladies that love peony paintings. So I know this is a sure sale. No, you never know if people are going to spend their money at that time or if they've moved on to something else or maybe they have 6 paintings of yours and they don't want the 7th or an 8th. They're fine with just 6. You know, they're totally fine. I mean, they love you, but they don't love you as much as you need for them to, you know, buy paintings from you. So I would say it's better to, it's you have an easier time living with yourself when you don't sell one of the paintings that was meaningful to you than when you don't sell a painting that you were like, you know what, I'm going to work on a month on this stupid painting that I don't care about, but I know it's going to sell. And if that one doesn't sell, you feel like such an idiot.
I think that was what I was talking about, because I think you had that once.
Oh, yeah.
That someone that was selling your work suggested that you painted something.
Yeah.
And you were like, no, I'm not sure. And he was like, you know, it's going to sell.
It was for an erotic show.
And it didn't.
In Spain.
And it didn't. And you felt 10 times worse because
I did three erotic paintings.
You hated the paintings?
Yes, with a passion.
But also you made them because you thought that even if you hated them, they were going to sell, and they didn't.
They didn't.
And I was also thinking about when, I mean, you had talked about this when you were working at a gallery and you were selling some, like a kind of paintings.
Okay. Like a, are we talking about the Boca galleries? The Boca gallery?
Yeah.
Okay, yeah.
So you were selling those paintings.
Yeah, tacky.
And you were selling at great prices.
Yeah, $30,000.
And you were selling a lot of paintings.
Yeah, I probably sold around 30 paintings, maybe.
Yeah, so you were selling tons of paintings, great price. But I remember when you were telling me afterwards about that. I mean, when we met and we were talking about that time of your life, I remember that you were like, you know, I was selling a lot, and I know that I had like a kind of a stable market there, because there were people buying and paying, like wanting those paintings.
Yes.
But you were not happy with the paintings.
No, I was ashamed of them, actually.
Yeah. And you, I remember how you said that you didn't want people to think about Nicolás Uribe and see that those paintings and think that that was you as a painter. So I think that in that case, you were being very successful at selling those paintings. But
well, that definition of success, let's
say. Yeah. Well, I mean, if you just see it by selling at a high price or whatever, like you were doing that, but you were not happy.
Not at all.
And you decided, you know what? I want to paint the things I want to paint.
Yes.
And I want, like, I'd rather have, as you were saying, paintings that I would, like a subject matter that I would love to paint, and that's a painting that's not going to sell.
Yeah.
Than to have like a painting that you really don't want to do selling, because you were not happy with it.
No, so, not at all.
I'm going to take 1 second out because it's Chili's dinner time. So
oh, okay.
We'll be back in a second.
Oh, that's why she was like all restless. Fine, yeah. Yeah. She's hungry. Anyways, but I hope that it's not that our job here is not to or people don't see our job here as somebody who is so highly critical of our, you know, kind of commercial world, or the role that the commerce of the art plays in the bigger art world. I hope that people don't see it like, okay, thank you, Buzzkill. Like, I was so, you know, wide-eyed and wanting to you know, take a chance on this, and this is totally, you know, not what I expected to hear. But I just think it's a conversation that is always worth having. It's a conversation that, sadly, I'm gonna be very, very honest here. Like, I have no issues speaking about my prior prices or prior sales or prior work, or when things didn't work out for the work that I was doing and or didn't sell. You know, I'm not going to bullshit about those things. But I am going to be very honest. I've met plenty artists in my life, and they were good people. They were cool people also. But they weren't sincere with those things. They really weren't. They weren't willing to speak about their experiences in their, like, in the art world. They weren't willing to share sale prices. I think even to this day, people have a really hard time. Like, artist friends of mine have a really hard time of being like super open. Like, if they sell something, you know, and you go like, oh, that's so awesome. Like, congrats. Like, you made a sale. That's awesome. Like, how much did you sell it for? I'm not happy with the price. I don't know. I don't know. And you go like, okay. Like, I wasn't going to think less of you. Like, for the painter friends that I have, sometimes they're like fucking ridiculously good painters. Like, you know, insanely good painters. I'm not going to think any less of them if they didn't sell like a couple of paintings. I could give a fuck. I could care less. If they told me like, dude, I fucking sold it for like $200. I'll be like, fuck, that's rad. That's so awesome that you sold something of yours at that price. That's awesome. I'd probably jump on the, you know, possibility of buying something for that price. But the reality is I would never, ever, like that would never, ever shape the idea I have of them and the respect that I have of them. So I don't know. I don't know why we're not sort of taught to be vulnerable enough, comfortable enough, and vulnerable enough to speak with clarity about these things. I think that if we were, like, we would have an easier time dealing with galleries. We would have a way easier time dealing with galleries. And we would know that, okay, this gallery, it's wanting me to do this. And they're talking to me like they sell work like hotcakes, like anything that they hang, they sell. And that's why they're asking so much of me. But I've talked to my friends and they were honest and they told me that, no, they actually sold 20% of my works. And it's like, hey, you sold 20% of their work in 3 years. Like, that's not, that those are not great numbers. I'm sorry. So we can, you know, that way we can have some sort of, I guess I'm not hoping for leverage, but at least like an even playing field. And you don't just show up at a gallery with your, like, you know, tail between your legs thinking like, I am undeserving of this and I certainly shouldn't be here. And whatever they throw at me, I'm going to think is amazing. And I'm going to say yes to any of the demands that they ask of me, which is usually how we artists behave in like gallery situations.
So this is a question regarding our books.
Yes.
Luisa Mago was saying how to get the PDF books. So Luisa, we have, if you see in the comments, there's a pinned comment, which would direct you to our webpage. Yeah. Or you can go to ourpaintedlives.com.
Yeah.
And super over easy. There, yeah, you would
easy peasy.
You can see the books if you want to get one, if you want to get two, if you're going to get three.
Yeah, they're a la carte if you want to buy, you know, two of them or three of them.
Or if you want a bundle.
Or if you want to buy the four books, there's a discount for you. And they're very fairly priced, once again.
Yes.
We think it's a very fair price.
Let's see. Raimo Galí, alias Sandalias, was saying, watching from a party, trying to hide away from the people. I'm thinking about
esa
the
fiesta,
meme.
Have you seen
Have you seen that meme?
Which that is the guy, like a, yeah, yeah, the troll on on the front door.
Like, and nobody knows that yeah. I'm watching OPL.
Yeah, I love that. Yeah. You know what? Nobody in there is as cool as you.
No.
Nobody. So that's fucking awesome. I think this is the first time that somebody tells us, like, I'm at a party, and honestly, this is the best thing. This is better than the party.
I'm in the bathroom, because I wasn't able to hear you probably.
Yeah, are you smoking pot over there?
No, shut up.
Yeah, sure. Shut up. Yeah, sure. Sure.
Who's talking over there?
Yep.
Let's see. A ver, ¿dónde estamos? Ritual. Who's saying, is for real? Did you have two kids? Human kids? Or do you mean pets? No, so Nicolás has two kids.
Oh, yeah.
Human kids.
Yeah.
Sam went fair.
Yeah, no. I don't like...
Kiwi,
I know, I'm super respectful.
No, but
I
they were saying human kids because maybe they don't know that you have
I've
kids.
Yeah, I've had dogs all my life. I was lucky enough to grow up with dogs.
But you've never had a Chili.
Love the dogs I've been with. Chili, ven, mira. No, es que hizo algo. I've loved every single one of my dogs that I've ever been with, that I've ever had the chance to share my life with and be happy, you know, and they filled me with joy. I don't call them kids. I call them my dog, and that is, I don't call them my babies. No, they are my dog. And when I say they are my dog, I mean that with the biggest amount of love and respect for a dog or for a pet that I could ever have. They're just wonderful, beautiful creatures that, you know, we are given a chance to share our lives with in this world. But no, they're not. When I say my kids, I mean my kids. Yeah, when Chili is not even a year old. She's going to turn a year in like a couple of weeks. And she's not even a year old, and she could be alone in the apartment. So that's my measure of who I call a kid. If they are not even a year old, and you could leave the apartment and just, you know, go to a movie, that is a pet. If they're not even a year old, and you cannot move without taking care of absolutely everything that they do, and, you know, be stressed about everything that they put in their mouths, and they depend entirely upon you, yeah, those are kids. Those are kids.
So, yeah, you don't call her your kid?
No.
But I do call her my baby.
No, that's... No. And you
I mean,
love Chili.
I created her.
Well, I don't know
how
that works, but...
It's a joke that we always have because you sent a video that you saw.
Yeah.
Of like... Yeah, it was a joke. So I always say that, I mean, I created her.
Yes, of course.
I had her. It was a C-section.
Yeah.
So let's see.
No, I have two kids, a boy and a girl. They are 16 and 12.
Yes. Catherine was saying, hello, Nico, Danny, Chili, and chat. Just popping in for a minute. It's bedtime over here. I love this painting so far.
Oh, thank
you. The roughness of the portrait right now is gorgeous. It reminds me a bit of the cover of Possibilities.
Oh.
I absolutely love it. Unfortunately, I have to go, so have a blast. See you. Bye.
Okay, that was a telegram.
No, but thank you for stepping in, Catherine, to say hi.
And stepping out.
And stepping out.
Yeah.
The
hell, Catherine?
It was like the Simpsons grandpa
moment.
Yeah.
Yeah, but with compliments.
Yeah.
Instead of getting to a strip club.
Yeah. J.E., the lone wanderer, was saying the hardest part is to commit to one idea. So when we were talking about like taking the risk with something. Yeah. Yeah, but I think that's also like a very important part of it. Because, I mean, if you don't commit to it, you're not going to give it your 100%. So, like, you're not giving it the opportunity to like, grow into something if you're not committing to it fully.
Yes.
And fully, I don't mean you have to put all your time to it. Because maybe you still
Every
have a job.
Every single dollar.
No, because maybe you still have a job that pays the bill. But you decide that you're going to have... All your spare time? Spare time to work on your paintings or on your sculptures or on your drawings or your animations, whatever. And if you give that thing that you're doing your 100%, it doesn't mean you can't go to your job because you're still having your job. It means that if you say you're going to commit to it, like on your spare time, you are going to do it. You are really committing to it. Let's see. Carla Anglada was saying, Catherine, congratulations on the show and the sales.
Yes.
And Cody was saying, Catherine, nice, congratulations. Let's see. Catherine Peremski was saying, it's upsetting that the artist never sees the money from the secondary market.
No.
It's not surprising, though.
No, of course. Could you imagine that?
Oh.
If we had any chance to see those, to see that money.
Amazing.
Yeah. I was paid, I could tell you this before we kind of stop because I actually like that this, I know that there's been a constant in some of the latter work that I've done where it's the paintings have a feel of like drawing. There's like a drawn feel to the paintings. I actually really like that. I don't know what I'm pursuing with that, but I actually really, really, really like that. And especially I want to be able to keep that knowing that, you know, I'm doing this other kind of cheekier series with those boxers where I'm able to like develop the painting like a little bit more. Doesn't make it like a better or worse painting. It just makes it like a different type of painting. So I'm kind of searching for something different when I approach the paintings. Like today, I'm approaching this painting, but me. I was gonna go somewhere with that, and I forget what I was gonna say. Fuck.
And I have no idea because you said
fuck
before I end up.
Yeah, I know. What the fuck?
So let's just talk about the books.
No, wait. But what was Catherine saying? Maybe it has to do with something.
That the people don't see the second.
Oh, right. No. Oh, yes. Thank you.
Like second market.
Yeah. So I think I've told you the story before.
Oh, yeah.
I did
because
a painting
talking
for Basel.
Yes.
I did a painting that ended up in Basel.
Oh, I know. I
this
know
one
that
time.
Story. Yeah.
And I think I got paid. I mean, I'm misremembering a little bit, but I don't think I'm off by a lot. I think I got paid anywhere around for the dollar at that time, like somewhere around $7,000, maybe, mm-hmm. maybe. It was a large painting. And that painting eventually was in Basel in Miami. And I say I got paid because I used to work for a person that repped me. And the way that, you know, my relationship with him would go is that he would just approach me and tell me, hey, we need two paintings of 80 by 60 in size, or we need something large. I remember him telling me, hey, we need something large for this painting. And I forget how large that painting was. It was about over 10 feet long, and it was maybe about 5 feet in height, something like that. Or maybe it was 4 foot something, and then over a little over 10 feet long. So it was a large painting. And I remember doing that painting. I really, really liked it. And I got actually paid before I finished the painting. So I got paid, you know, money in hand, and I was like super happy because you're like, hell yeah, I'm working on something that is not like, oh, am I going to get paid? When am I going to get paid? Like, this is ridiculous. And you have to call somebody just to push them to you know, pay you and to honor their side of the agreement. No. I got paid. So I was like, fuck yeah. Awesome. And I got paid what I thought was like a, you know, fair amount of money. And then months later, I never knew about this, but a friend of mine just shows me, actually there were two people,
a friend
of mine in school,
right?
Yeah, that went to Basel and took a picture of my painting. And then one of my father's cousin that mm-hmm. lives in Miami went to Basel and, you know, liked the painting. And he was like, dude, I like this painting. And I took a photo and I didn't realize it was yours until I asked, and he sent me a photo, and I was like, what? I have no idea. And I was like a little pissed because I was like, hey, I should, I remember telling the person that was my rep, and he was a good friend. I remember telling him like, dude, you should tell me these things because that's a cool thing to put in your CV, right? Like your painting was shown in Basel. So that's pretty awesome. But the reason that he wasn't telling me these things is because he didn't want to share with me like
the price
that the secondary market was that the painting was going for. And the painting sold, because I know it sold, for $60,000.
And you got paid $7,000.
And I was like, are you fucking kidding me? Like, that is, I mean, I felt, and then I don't know what I felt. I didn't think I felt anything, but I felt weird. I didn't feel like I was being robbed, because I remember like just gathering my feelings and saying like, when they paid me the $7,000, did I feel it was fair? And I answered to myself, yes. So I was like, I didn't feel like I was robbed back then. I felt it was fair. And I think that that's a very important thing. And then when I heard that it was there, I was like, oh, this is cool. I mean, I don't like to put the weight of validation,
success, yeah,
the
there.
Weight of validation, exactly, of being successful on, you know, on the shoulders of being part of a stupid show, of, you know, a stupid biennial or a show or a fair. I don't like that. I'm not a better painter because I showed in Basel. Like, it's stupid. It never even depended on me. You know, it was just, you know, out of my hands. So what can I feel about that? Nothing. But I always felt it was very curious. It was just really, really curious. And I remember when I brought it up to the person, it was almost as if I had learned something that I wasn't supposed to learn.
Yeah.
Which I was like, why is this not something that we can speak about? Like, this
guess,
is so stupid.
I mean, I guess it's because you realized how you were something I mean, how that, like, you meant business to him.
Oh, yeah.
Because then you realized, okay, it's not like he's going to buy this and he's going to make some money. It's like he's making tons of money.
Well, he was afraid that I was going to be like, hey, I
now
know
I'm
what you're selling.
Ask you for,
when you tell me to do a painting, it's not going to be seven. It's going to be 20 because I know what you're making. But what I then realized is like there's so many people involved in that sort of chain and they all want their money. They all want to make their money. And the funniest thing is that the artist is always at the end of that chain.
Yeah, I mean, it even makes sense because, I mean, when a gallery has like their lists of clients, they're not going to share it with the artist.
No,
ever, because they don't want the artist to sell to those buyers directly.
Yeah.
Because then they're not going to get their cut. So it's the same with the person that was representing you.
Yeah. Yeah. So. Very nervous he got. But anyways, that's a true story. True story.
And to end in an amazing note.
Oh, amazing. What is this? Chili made another sale?
Yeah.
Chili and Zwirner are on good terms?
Chili, I said. Chili.
Yeah.
Like Chili. Chili.
What? Go on. Like Egon Chili. Okay.
Like Egon Chili.
Well, yeah, I mean, that's her thing. She's Russian-Mexican.
Yes. I was going to say, if maybe someone's new here, or if maybe someone's joined the conversation, the stream, after we talked about the new addition that we have on our webpage.
Okay, yeah.
We're going to let you know that the PDFs for the books we've done are available at our website. I don't know why it's sounding so weird. Let me go back.
I think you're doing great.
Yeah.
No, this is perfect.
Okay, so let's continue. There is the painter book available.
Yeah.
There is the Our Painted Lives book available.
Yeah. Those are chronological order. You're citing them. Yeah.
There's the Possibilities book available.
Yeah, that was last year.
And there's a new one that we did which hasn't been printed.
Yeah,
we never sold like a physical copy of it.
No, it's not going to be physically commercially available as an edition, as a published edition.
Mm-hmm.
No, it's not. This is how we are hoping to, like, this by design, and Danny and I had a talk. This is how we decided to make it available for everyone.
Yes, and this last book.
Yeah.
Is 432 pages.
It's a Bible.
So it is a Bible. Our Painted Lives
Thank
Bible.
Thank God.
Our Bible lives.
God bless us.
Yeah. So you can get those in our webpage. I was seeing that Shannon Hagen was saying, oh my God, I got the whole book. I thought it was just one print.
No.
So
it's
no.
It's the book. Yeah.
Yes. So you will get the book.
Yep.
And there's a bundle.
Yeah, so the image, just to clear that up, the image that you see in the product description is just a sample page
of the book.
But the books have, like, Our Painted Lives has 150 pages, Painter has 150 pages, Possibilities is 200 pages, and Our Painted More Possibilities is 432. So I think I roughly around there, and if I'm mistaken, I apologize, but it's you're getting a book. You're getting a whole book. And the cool thing is you can print it. If you find, because I was thinking about this, if you find that 432 pages, it's like, oh my God, that's like an unbearable book, or maybe it's too expensive. If you know a little bit of like editing in, Acrobat, you know, if you have Adobe Acrobat and where you can edit PDFs, you can actually make a smaller PDF, or you can actually take it to the printer and say, you know what? I want to have the first part of this book printed. Don't worry. Like, you can use the wraparound cover. You can use the end covers to design it. But I wanted to stop at page 150 because I can only pay X amount of dollars for this to be printed. And then you have, you know, more possibilities A, you know, or tome one. And then, you know, 6 months from now, you print tome two.
Or the good
thing.
And
you have a cool collection.
And the good thing about it is that you don't have to print it to have it. Like,
oh,
you don't have to have the physical thing because you're getting the book.
It looks really good on screen,
yes.
I would say.
And you can like zoom in.
Yeah,
and you
looks
can
good.
See the paintings.
Our
the pages.
Reproductions, I'm always very proud. Sometimes like with the Our Painted Lives, which was a sketchbook. There was no way of taking photos of that sketchbook. I mean, it was impossible to open and pages stuck. I mean, it was a mess. So that one had to be scanned. I think almost all of the paintings there are scanned. In some paintings, I found a way to like take a photo, but it was almost impossible. So there's always like the little bit of glare that you get when scanning, but they're very good images. Like they're
yes.
very, very good. We're very proud of that.
Again, if you buy it and you want to have it, like you don't have to invest more in printing it.
I bought it.
On printing it because you already have it and you
yes.
can go to it in your computer, your iPad, your tablet,
yeah,
whatever.
Yeah, yeah.
It's always going to be there
always
for you.
There.
So it would be very cool if
yeah.
you get it and you can show it to us.
Yeah, if you print it.
Or if you don't.
It
I mean,
doesn't matter.
We've seen people that buy it and they're recording like them scrolling
yeah.
through.
Super happy
the book,
zooming in.
Which
your
is
iPad.
Amazing. We
your
are
iPad
super happy
should,
to
your
see
tablet,
that.
Your tablet, it should look. Pretty cool, I would say.
Yeah.
And if you're like me, that you can actually, that what I like to do is to have like a two-page view of the book so you can actually have a sense of the spread rather than each page because
mm-hmm.
I really like seeing spreads. And for example,
because it was
the,
designed.
Yeah, for example, for I think the more obvious one is the Our Painted Lives sketchbook that sometimes I would just flip it on the side and then do a two-page spread painting. Because I wanted it to be a little bit bigger. So, you know, it makes more sense when you see it as a two-page. But that's just like in the viewing tab, you just go view and then
two
you
pages,
just say
double
two page.
Pages. Yeah,
yeah. You just go to the two-page. You just let the cover be a single page. There's also like an option that you can tick so that the cover is like a single page. And then you go a two-page spread. And that way you have a sense of exactly what the book feels like. But those are all like little things that you can tick in like your Adobe Reader and your PDF Reader, which are super simple to do. But even if you're just scrolling like one page, one like individual pages, it should give you like a sense of like, it should have like a sense of cadence, like a rhythm, like a visual rhythm to it that's very nice. We obviously, and by we I mean mostly Danny, designs it so that we can, as viewers, have like a really cool sort of pairing.
Like
and
a reading,
the way,
yeah.
The position.
Like a smooth.
Yeah, it's like super
transition.
Simple stuff, but I think it's elegant stuff, like the positioning on the page, when it bleeds, when it actually has like a box that it's in, when it's a spread. I mean, all these things are considered. All these things were like designed. And so we're very proud of that. I mean, this is all work that we've done for years, but we're very, very proud of it. And we're proud that it can actually... be presented to the people that we love and that we care about, that is our community, in a way that it doesn't feel like, you know, nobody's taking advantage of anyone here. It's an affordable price. And if you are willing to pay for that price, we're also telling you, hey, we are granting you the permission and we are the ones that can do this as owners of that copyright. We're granting you the permission
for
to
personal
print,
use printing.
Yeah, to print those books and not feel weird about anything. Like,
yeah. So Jeff Akov was saying, I think most printers are going to refuse to print it because they will think we won't have the copyright. So I was going to say, if you see in the product, it says permission is granted to print physical copies strictly for personal and non-commercial use only.
Yeah, you can redirect them, Jeff, to our page.
No, and again, if you're going to print one copy, they're not going to have a problem with it. I mean, if you go to a printer and you say, I want 1,000 copies of it, then you will have a problem with it. But if you're going to have a print for you, I mean, one copy is never
That's
a problem for
no,
printers.
And it could be a number of copies because you want to give them to your family. And it's fine. What's important is that it's for personal use and that you're not trying to like resell it. And,
yeah.
But we trust. I mean, we spoke about this last time, but... we have an immense amount of trust and love for our community. So,
so
I think that's super cool.
Yeah, we're super happy
yes.
with it.
Yes.
We hope you guys enjoy it.
Yes, and we're very grateful for the people that have gotten it.
Yes.
We've only gotten like super cool comments, like people very happy. People like, you know, they were surprised that they were getting so much when they were downloading it.
Mm-hmm.
And we're immensely happy that people can... maybe they didn't have the opportunity to back us when we were doing our Kickstarter projects, But maybe, you know, we can make up for it and make it available.
In a different way,
yeah. Yeah, in a different way, but it, and also make it like super accessible. So
yes.
Hopefully you'll see that there's a cool kind of sharing spirit that has always been part of what we do inside these books.
Yes. So I think that's it.
Yeah.
For today.
Yes.
Thank you everyone
Thank
for being
you.
Here.
Thank you.
I have to say, I really love the painting.
I like it too. Very fair.
I love it.
Yeah, it's very, yeah, I like it.
I love it.
I sometimes have a hard time because I'm like, I don't know if people are going to believe me. Like, I could just say I like everything. But obviously when it's a painting of you, a painting of Samuel,
like,
or a
it.
Painting of Fer, and there is something that I see them, you know, if I see them in there in some way, and it's a very abstract way, I feel.
But it's...
I mean, just go back to...
Her.
Yeah, for everyone watching, go back to when I scraped it. And see where that was born, where that painting was being born. And there's like a little bit of a struggle and desperation because I'm always like, whenever I paint somebody I love and care about, there's always like that little sense of urgency trying to capture that person. And as soon as I felt that she was there, I was like, yes, that's, you know, this is what we've been working for in these,
yes.
like this past hour, just searching for this.
And also,
yep.
If someone liked this painting
yeah.
and they want to have it,
yeah.
it's going to be available at our website
yeah.
again.
Yeah.
It is over there.
It's going
to be over yeah. there. And the Soda Popinski.
Soda Popinski.
Which is amazing.
Yeah, I love it. That's an actual sticker.
It is an actual sticker.
Actual sticker covering his penis.
Yeah.
So, and somebody asked me about this, and we can finish this. But somebody asked, well, why, like, what does that have to do with like censorship? Like, why are you covering genitals? Which I obviously have no issue painting genitals. Like,
no, and I think it's...
I've never
it
edited...
It looks like a joke.
Even in like my older paintings, never edited a painting. If
no.
I was painting, you know, breasts, I would never blur a nipple. I would never... I was like, I refuse to do this. Like, I didn't do it on
no,
Facebook.
No, you do that openly, but I would also say it, of course, reads as an intentional thing. It's
yeah.
not like... Oh, I'm going to cover this nude pose and I'm
no,
going to put
no,
like
I don't like
cherry.
It. I always feel,
no.
can I be honest with you? I always feel like painters are a little bit cowardly when they do that. I don't like it. You know what? I would have to look back. I have a post on Facebook and I was like a little bit of an idiot back then. But I have an old post on Facebook when they were starting to censor things where I took this photograph from this like well-known photographer and it was a nude of a woman. And I blurred everything except the breasts. I blurred everything, and the breasts are like in super sharp focus compared to the blur. And I was like, "Fuck it! Like this is ridiculous. It's always been absurd." So no. So going back to like censorship,
mm-hmm.
this actually has to do with Soda Popinski's history of censorship, because when he was in the arcade, which was the first video game, let's say the first sort of iteration of that Punch-Out video game that. Eventually became the NES, like Mike Tyson's Punch-Out. But in the arcades, he was called Vodka Drunkensky. So, you know, he would have a bottle and he would get drunk on vodka. And if you look at the comments he has after the fight, like if, you know, if he wins or loses or if he beats you, it's always about drinking. It's always about how he's hammered. He can't drive back home. I mean, it's always acknowledging that he's drunk. So it's awesome. So what's funny was that when Nintendo published the video game, the Mike Tyson's Punch-Out, they were like, no, 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 we can't have him drink. I mean, they didn't alter the quotes, which is hilarious. So the quotes make no sense because he is actually speaking as if he was a drunk. But they changed his vodka drinking to soda drinking, to pop soda pop drinking. So they changed his name from Vodka Drunkensky to Soda Popinski. So... It was just like a cheeky commentary on Soda's own history of like this slight censorship. And I was like, this is perfect. And I found like the perfect sticker, perfect proportion. And I was
yeah.
like, we got to put it in there. But I'm having a blast painting those. I really am. They take a little bit longer than what I usually take when painting. But I'm loving just painting all those like... You know, massive bodies that feel super fleshy. So I'm just having a, you know, it's super super fun. So, anyways.
Anyways, so thank you everyone.
Thank you, Daniel Lira.
Here, remember to visit our webpage, and we'll see you soon.
Yeah, and I just wanted to publicly say you did an awesome job on that book. That book is 100% Danny. In you know, Danny made that book, the More Possibilities.
Thank you. Book. Happy you liked
it. I think you did an incredible job at doing something that's seemingly impossible, which is trying to put, you know, over 400 images together in something that doesn't look like a clusterfuck, you know.
I have to say something that makes me very proud.
Mm-hmm.
The selection that we had for this book, like, I wanted to have every single image that we had on that folder in the book.
Yes.
And I did it.
That's incredible.
Incredible. That's like a pat on my back with that.
No, it's okay. You deserve it. I think you did an incredible
like
job.
Like a puzzle.
And I think people that have downloaded the book will 100% say, this is an absurd thing to just try to put these images together. And I think you did an amazing job.
Thank you.
Thank you so much,
Daniel Lira. I'm happy you enjoyed it.
Of course.
And I am happy that we have our painted lives together.
Okay, that was...
I love you. Okay. Goodbye.
This is a little sappy.
Thank you, everyone. I have to take Chili to the park.
I'm uncomfortable in this chair. I wish I had like a stirrup.
Goodbye, everyone.